to order. First on my agenda would be any personal appeals. Anyone with a personal appeal, if you'd like to approach the podium, state your appeal. Hearing none, we can move on. This afternoon, what our goal is to get through the items that Mr. Pepe sees as important in our budget discussion. I'm hoping that by the end of today, we have all the pertinent information to begin making decisions. Now, I see you have decisions on here, and I think you're just going to inform us at this point, not ask for official action on decisions, or...
Well, I
tell you what you're looking for, so I know we're on the same page.
Discussion regarding most of these.
Very good.
Because depending on where we go with them determines what our final numbers are budgetarily.
Agreed.
Now, understand that the majority of these are items where throughout the year you say, don't worry, we'll deal with it at budget time. So,
there
we are.
Budget time. But if there's something we feel strongly on today, should we be making a motion?
I would. This is a public meeting. It's a publicly advertised meeting.
So we can vote.
So you can vote to put it into the budget. Remember, your final budget decisions are made in public on the floor in a council meeting. But today is there's no time better than today, or your budget workshop on Thursday, or
so this
next
is advertised
Tuesday.
As a workshop itself. So
yeah.
Other members of council can make motions
absolutely.
And vote as well.
Okay. This is a full meeting.
So
of
everybody understand about you.
That means we want to move something around or delete something.
Yeah, that's right.
You have to
hold
the forward.
Right.
And we got to publicly today anyway.
The only time where you're not going to be able to do that is, so this is advertised as a public workshop, as a workshop for the full council. The 14th is as well. So is the 9th. But the meeting on the 26th, I have listed in your budget meetings that it's a workshop if needed.
Okay.
All right. Now, it was advertised as a budget and finance committee meeting.
So we can review the final budget
as a committee. However, if that has to be a workshop for any reason, I need to advertise it. That will be a public budget workshop of the full council.
Okay.
All right. The goal is between today, Thursday, and in particular, the 19th, which is that annual do or die, you're going to be here till the bitter end meeting, to have this done. But if we have to go to the 26th, then we have to go to the 26th. The goal is to advertise this thing, well, to have your first reading on December 2nd, which is right here, with a final passage 2 weeks from that day, so December 16th. Okay?
Very good.
So really today is kind of let's kind of set a direction. I would think Thursday is going to be, let's talk numbers, and then next Thursday or next Tuesday will be, here we are. All right, and hopefully
what do we need to do to get right back up, balanced budget? Yeah.
Now, I've told all department managers that starting Thursday, I would recommend they be in these meetings. And if they want to be here today, which two of them decided they have nothing better to do. But I told them that Thursday and next Tuesday, I think, are crucial because if we're making decisions and we want to look back there and say to them, look, guys, what's going on here? Or we think about doing this. We need your input or we're going to tell you however it works out. What I did was I gave you a button back piece of paper here. It's my original. As to the, I guess, budget discussion items that we need to really kind of focus on and make some big decisions about. Okay.
Very good.
Before I can really plug.
Before you plug in real numbers.
What their numbers are.
Got it.
I gave you a preliminary budget again Friday.
Yes.
Christine and I had gone through all the insurances. Christine went through them again today. I have a couple small changes to make. I don't think they're workers' comp and life insurance. I don't think they're anything too significant. But we'll get into that as well.
And that's an up-to-the-minute document up there.
What this is through November 8th. All right, so Friday at about 2 o'clock, I typed in all of your actual numbers. All right, so this is good as of 2 o'clock on Friday.
Okay? Whatever happened today is not in here. Did anything happen today?
No more receipts, Brian. Good, don't worry about things.
All right. So you want to go write down your list? Is that how you want to
do it? Well, I'll write down the list.
Okay, is that okay?
Yes, sir.
All right, so, and I'll tell you, these questions, some of these questions are not just a couple minutes. I mean, they're going to be lengthy discussion items. The first thing is we need to decide what the swimming pool rates are going to be. In particular, we know what happened this year. We know what the final numbers were. If you go to the Parks and Recreation swimming pool section of your binder.
Is it called swimming pool?
It might be.
Yeah, it is.
I wrote that down. I'm looking for the rates in there.
That would be the fee schedule.
Fee schedule at the back of the rate. I wrote it down. So we took a hit this year. We raised our rates drastically. I don't think that it necessarily worked out for us in the process that we determined. I don't know. So I don't think it necessarily worked out for us in the process that we used this year. I think we priced out a considerable amount of the former clientele that we had. We just priced them out. I think the fact that we do not accept a credit card down there also is extremely detrimental to us.
Absolutely.
I think if someone came up with a family and the bill was $35, there are not a whole lot of people that have $35 extra in their wallet that they're willing to put out of the pool, but if they can swipe a credit card, I think it would happen. Now, I don't know if a point of sale device, which I saw Staples sell for a few hundred dollars now, a point of sale device is an option for down there that would make sense. I don't know that the internet connection is there to run it properly, but I think it's definitely a conversation to have soon about point of sale device for the pool. That when someone comes up, they can at least swipe a credit card to pay it.
I'd actually take it further. I know we're slightly off topic, but across the borough, I think that would be something that, I mean, the conversation is already there and has to be done right and has to be cost effective. But there are certain things that it's just the reality of where we are in the world. People are looking to use that.
Yeah, so I have no issue with the point of sale device. As a matter of fact, one of the companies I'm talking to is actually a local bank, it's TD Bank, does the online bill pay. One of the things that they offer is the point of sale devices as well. We have to be online to be able to run that, if I'm correct.
We should have free internet down there from our agreement with service.
Yeah, I don't think that's the case.
But that is part of the agreement, so if they need to run it down there, it's definitely part of it, because I remember.
Right, but I'm not sure that we actually have
it. We don't have it right now.
Yeah. I don't think we can. So,
but it shouldn't be a problem to get it, correct?
Well, no, not necessarily. That depends on where lines and cables come in. Yeah, while they may offer the service for free, you've got to get it there first.
They're going to have to be right above the pool.
But we're going to have that ran in. That won't be free. I can promise you that. They probably offer the service to us for free, but they're not going to send their labor out here and run a cable to us for free. So it's something that we need to think about. Okay.
I think more importantly, though, the numbers of what we're charging people.
Yeah.
I believe they need to go down. I believe the number of people we had at the pool was not enough to justify our expense for the pool this summer. Now, I'm not saying that's only because we raised fees, but I think reducing fees makes a big difference down there. I hope it makes a big difference down there. And I don't know if anyone has recommendations, if what we did was so far out of range. I don't know if the three categories are necessary. I don't know if we go back to resident, non-resident, and make non-resident fees affordable. I don't know if anyone has a feeling about what we need to change to have more people down there.
Cool.
Yeah, so you brought in $87,621 this year. You budgeted $110,000.
And the previous year, just because I don't know.
You brought in $103,000.
$103,000. Before that, we had $118,000, $115,000.
Right.
So we were typically well over
That was a rainy year.
Well, in 2012, you could probably accommodate some of that to, we changed the rate July 1st.
Right.
So the season passes were already purchased, but the daily admissions went down.
Correct.
Your rate directly affected the number of pavilions as well.
Yes.
The pavilion rate?
It's in your fee schedule at the back, page 5 of the fee schedule, which is a
yellow tab.
A gold tab all the way towards the back. There's a fee schedule in there on page 5 that tells us swimming pool rates. So I don't know if people are interested in eliminating that non-resident category, if we're interested in merging non-resident. The East Penn School District resident, I don't think worked well in our favor. I think it was complicated to determine whether someone was or wasn't. It's not as difficult to determine when they're a resident, but once they're not a resident, I think it becomes difficult to say, oh, you are an East Penn School District resident, or you aren't. So it's a lot more on a 15-year-old cashier to try and figure that out. We're putting a lot of responsibility there.
Okay, so then let's eliminate that category and only have borough and non-borough.
Anyone object to that idea?
The problem with borough is there's more people in the borough. We have a mailing address, but not a within borough.
So they have a street list down there.
Or you could be up in Milford and have
a borough. Right. So they have a street list down there that says, when they ask for the license, that says this number on this street, yes, you're a borough resident. Now, it does also become a little complicated, like when you talk about Millbrook Farms, there are a lot of people with Emmaus addresses that live in Millbrook Farms that don't live in the borough of Emmaus. It's a couple dollars every time. I don't know. I don't know how you solve the problem with a person there.
The system they're using is actually a paper. I mean, they're actually
piece of paper.
Through a booklet. It would not be a challenge other than having the equipment there. I mean, a simple database, if you type this address in, and it doesn't show up. All the addresses are there.
Because I have the borough tax. Borough tax records.
The borough, but also all of East Penn School District is not challenging.
So it's easy enough to have a database, take a person's license, type it in, it would say Emmaus resident or non-resident.
It could be on a little netbook. I mean, it costs $100 to search through it. The database could be updated. I wouldn't even think there'd be a need to update it more than once a year.
Right.
It doesn't change that quickly. And if there was some sort of exception. But I actually like those. The caution that I use, I think that we are off on the pricing. I think it does need to back down a little bit. But one of the things that there is still a consensus of people that are not interested in going to the pool. This year, attendance was down. I think the clientele did change. The behavior problems, I think, changed. And if we let this go for a little bit longer, I think it starts to bring some of the people that wrote off the idea of going to the pool, once the trend is going in their direction, that they feel like they could go down there. I think I don't want to move too far so that we only had a bad year, and now we're back to where we were, and then we have people that are disappointed when they go back to the pool. I think we made a step in the right direction of getting people that they said, you know what, I like the feel of the pool, but it has to be financial.
You know, I think though that I remember the conversation very clearly a year ago when we had this. Actually a year and a half ago. Do you think maybe we reacted too quickly at that point? Because one of the questions that I asked our pool manager is, hey, you've been here for a number of years. How many people have you ever kicked out of here? And the answer was none.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, if a person's acting like an idiot, what do? You get rid of them. Instead, it was, you know, I think it blew up to be this super-sized problem that really, maybe the solution wasn't let's cut everybody off at the knees, because that's what we did. I mean, now I have A&M from Salisbury calling me going, hey, I've been going to your pool for 30 years, I'm not going anymore. Because we had a group of invalids that, quite honestly, I don't think we were policing very well. And I think we've got to kind of think about that end of it, too, is how well were we doing in terms of policing patrons there and taking care of it,
yeah,
you know, at the incident?
I think on the big incidents, that's an easy thing to accomplish. But the calls that I would get are really stuff that is hard to police. It's, oh, you know, it's a group that was down there, and they were so noisy and rowdy. But where is the line? I mean, that's really a judgment call, and is a 18-year-old kid really going to be the one that is the authority that can say, you know what, that group really is too loud, or why is this group not too loud? Too? You know, I mean, it's...
Well, it's shame on us for not hiring a full manager that can handle it.
Oh, I agree with that. I think it takes a very skilled person to find that line. And some of the stuff is partially perception, too, unfortunately. So...
Yeah, I agree.
You know, I mean, yes, we could enforce very strict rules, which I think that we should. But some of the stuff still exists, like people being loud. I mean, yes, they're having a fun time. Where is that line that you say, you know, you've crossed fun, now you're rowdy?
Now, I do think $15 is an unreasonable amount to charge to get into that pool. The facility that we provide is not worth $15.
We're going to the water park in Canoble's free.
I just don't think what we provide is worth. I mean, I think we reacted a little harshly, and we did solve the problem. I mean, the problem was not there this summer, but the problem cost us $30,000. So
I agree.
We need to somehow recoup that $30,000 and also manage the problem.
Right. The only thing I'm cautioning is: have we started to create the perception that the pool is inviting for all Emmaus residents, even the people that for years have written off the idea of going to the pool because they put in their mind that there's a stigma associated with the pool.
It was empty the majority of the summer. Like if I went to the pool, it was empty. At night, it was empty. Now, we did have some events that packed some people in, but those were the times that it was a dollar.
Right.
And I think the mentality of people is, you know, the cheaper it is, the more I'll frequent it. And I think I'd rather have too many people at the pool as a problem than nobody at the pool and none of them. And I don't know how the majority of our community feels. You know, we did the survey the year before and found out how they felt and then reacted. I don't know if we did. The regulars at the pool saw it as there aren't enough people at this pool. Why do we have such a big pool with nobody in it?
Right. No, I
so something rate-wise has to change cautious for us to make more money. I don't know if anyone...
Dr. Lyle.
Well, two suggestions. First of all, I think we've identified we had a management. I think we can take care of that. I think that's somewhere else on here. I think we should revert back to whatever the numbers were, whatever the rates were in the previous and what we did before. But a change I'm going to make, and I'll play devil's advocate a little bit, and this whole Emmaus resident, non-resident, I think you just say anybody that has an Emmaus mailing address. It just makes it so simple. Show an ID. Yeah, I don't know if we lose money. But if we extend that out a little bit, maybe we'll actually bring some more people in at the Emmaus rate. Yeah, you might have some upper Milford people or whoever else, you know, as we go out here that has an Emmaus. Does that really matter? It has to be specifically upper. If we want to bring more people in, they come in under that little lower rate then. I don't have and it's much easier for a 15-year-old checking it. You don't have to have electronics to do it. You don't have to have technology. You just show an ID of some sort with your mail and address on it. It says Emmaus.
Well, younger kids wouldn't, there are people who wouldn't even know, do you live in Emmaus? Well, their mailing address is Emmaus, they might say, yes, I live in Emmaus.
Yeah.
So I just don't see why we should get hung up on, is it truly within the borough confines, or is it just Emmaus mailing address? And I go back to the last...
The previous rate.
So that's not...
I mean, it's still...
Yeah, do we remember
what were the rates were
based on what we see? I think we just had Emmaus and non-resident at that point, correct? And I believe that the rates then were actually what you see for East Penn School District.
All right, so I think you're right. Here are your...
So there they are. Non-resident.
Yeah, so... You had
address and non-Emmaus address.
Yeah, I personally don't like, I mean, I like the idea. I mean, the Emmaus resident is paying their tax. Like, that's the factor that I think is the variable. Is that they've already contributed to
strong.
And I
find
financial.
I prefer. prefer that way, that if the people pay their taxes in Emmaus, they receive the benefit of it.
Let me take it further than that, and we've talked about this at committee level, is that it's also come to our attention that how strictly that is enforced is also something that is...
And that's management. I mean, this all comes down. The bigger picture of us making rules and that not being followed is management. So I think we just need to, I'm fine with going back to that. I would like to see senior citizens get an even better deal. I don't think we ever have an issue with senior citizens at our pool. I don't think we're ever going to say, we've got too many senior citizens at the pool, we've got a problem.
Or we're cool.
Right? Too rowdy.
Yeah, you know, I don't think that will ever be. The more senior citizens at our pool, the better, because I think they help us enforce behavior, help us enforce those issues.
Well, you know, one of the things that I've heard from a couple of them is they'd also like to see some of those senior adults ones back too, and some of the programming that we used to do.
A decent manager will enact what the customers want, and I don't think that'll be a problem. So I say go back to those old prices.
Is that a...
I'll make a motion, go back to the old prices, and to reduce senior citizen fees to $3 for all senior citizens at all times.
So what year, why don't you say, if I may, which year of prices?
2012 prices.
2012 beginning of season
prices. Yes, beginning of 2012 season prices, and reduce all senior citizen rates to $3 at all times. 62. 62.
All right, I'll second that.
Discussion.
Yeah. Go ahead. I personally think, just based on the history of conversations over the last 8 years, listening to things, we didn't change them for a long time, then we slowly increased them, then we made this big, huge jump. I don't think that we were on the wrong track. I mean, for 6 or 7 years, we talked about this type of structure. We probably just went too far with non-resident. I think that we should just be focused on the non-resident and try and bring that back to what we think is more realistic. I think that we're going to see an increase in people. But I think that we were on the right track, even though we lost some of the people. I think that we would see that increase regardless, because some of the stigma was dropping.
Really, too.
I'm
opposed
to
6 years.
What we had last year, what we see right now.
And then you've got to drop senior citizens to three at all times.
I think that we should keep non-resident. And let's reduce that amount.
What about your season passes?
Guest passes. I'm just going to leave that for a minute.
Well, wait a minute.
Okay, so we're on full rates. Full rates for general, and these are daily.
Okay, so we dropped the prices back down to 2012.
Beginning of the year
the
prices.
Beginning of the year.
And change senior citizens.
Senior citizens are down to $3 for non-resident as well?
Yes, all senior citizens, all times, $3. I don't think we'll ever have a problem with the senior citizen.
Why are we going that route? Do we have a motion on the floor for?
We're still under discussion. We're just,
Clarify. Yeah.
Any other discussion on that motion?
Well, what happened with the non-resident rate then? What does that goes from 15
up here, Doc. It goes over
that.
There to $8.
Thank you.
It follows the East Bend School District resident.
That must be wrong. It's got to be.
It must be backwards.
Yeah.
Can we clarify that? All right. All in favor? We have 4 ayes to this opposed. Mr. Barrett is opposed. All right. Now let's discuss season passes.
What was last year's? I don't see it. 2012 family.
So 2013, we had 3 categories. I'm believing that, and I'm not.
Yeah, here's your 20. I'm sorry. Here's your 2013.
Thank you. 2013 rates: borough resident, East Penn School District resident, and then we also had a non-resident, which those are in your fee schedule on page 6 of the fee schedule. If you turn to the back, the 2013 rates are on there. 5 and under has always been free for a season pass. I'm a little curious that we charge 500 is free, 6 through
17.
Through 17, which is a broad gap, but I see why it is that way. Was 40.95 and 145. Adults were 80, 150, 200. Family was 125, 200, 250.
Don't pay any attention to this. The projector compressed them. That's what it's doing. Yeah.
So I would recommend that we there. I guess we'd go back.
Well, the assumption. I just want to see what the 2012 was. All right. So they were 40 and change there. 80, 125.
I can probably go over.
Oh, senior citizens went up $10. 40. Non-resident.
So resident, I don't know that resident needs to change.
40, 25.
The question would then be, what do we want non-residents to be? And I think it would make sense for us to eliminate that school district. If we did it for general admission, it would make sense to eliminate it also for season passes. And then we'll have to come up with numbers or follow the.
Yeah, so here's your,
or follow 2011, 2012,
here's your current.
I think current's okay, right? Anyone object to the current?
Yeah.
For the what family?
Family at 125, I still think is a pretty good deal.
How many in the family?
Adult, the two adults and anyone living in the household under
23.
No, we changed it. We changed the age.
Whatever.
23. 25.
I think we said 23.
I think 23 for some reason.
The assumption was that you could still be in college.
And still be living at home.
It could still be any of those things.
What can we do with the military rate? Can we do a military rate or not? No, we didn't do a military rate.
We should have done one. Everybody does now.
Military being active service?
Yeah,
everybody's
doing it now. Honorably discharged.
I don't have a problem adding that.
I don't either.
So is everyone okay with the borough resident rate leaving it where it stands?
40.
I think 62 and older maybe should go to $20.
You raised, well, that was 20, and you went to 20, you went to 30.
So me. So if we go back to 2011 rates, you're getting 0, 40, 80, 125, 20. Those rates, everybody see that? 0, 40, 80, 125, 20. So I'll make a motion to change residential season passes for 2013 to children 0 to 5, no charge, children 6 to 17, $40, adults 18 and over, $80, families including children residing in the household 23 and under to 125, and senior citizens 62 and older, $20. I'll make that into a motion.
A second.
Discussion. All in favor? We have four ayes. Those opposed? Mr. Barry is opposed. Then we need to discuss non-residents.
All right, so your current non-resident rate, you have the East Penn School District rate and the non-resident rate, 95, 150, 240, then 145, 200, 250, and 60. Just for the record, let me go in and show you what your season sales were.
I
And now it's gone.
How'd you lose it?
The new program.
Yeah.
He's going to pass 5 years in the middle.
Yeah, I see that.
You call it something.
Just do a search up in the right hand corner.
Yeah. Yeah, let me go back to the entire thing. I'm not over here. Okay, so last year you sold 8 non-resident passes, and a typical year you sell somewhere around 30 to 50. That's combined the EPSD and the non-resident. So really it's 23.
So you're only down.
In a typical year you sell somewhere in between 30 and 50. Okay.
30, so we probably only lost 10.
That's just family.
Okay, so we're not selling that many family passes outside of.
Really,
so I don't know that any drop is going to be, anything is going to be major in that. I think it's our daily admission of non-residents.
That's where you got.
That's where we lost.
That's really where we took our big loss.
Non-resident, you had 2.
So non-resident rates, what were they in the past?
Non-resident? Season pass. Everything, we just added a second.
So it was a 95, 150, 200, 40?
Something very close to there. 40 wasn't, it was probably 20.
I agree, I'll go back. And that's what I would like to see go back to.
For what? For seniors?
Yeah.
It's 35.
It's 35.
Previously 35?
Yeah.
I'm fine with 20 for seniors. That's not a problem.
So I'll make a motion to change non-resident season pass rates to 5 and under free, 6 through 17, $95.
Hold on a second. Let me catch your change.
050. 6 to 17, $95.
Okay.
18 plus, $150. Family, 200. Senior citizen, 20. Not resident, yeah. Is there a second to the motion?
Non-residents.
Thank you. Go ahead, Wes. Discussion.
If anything, let's keep. It has nothing to do with the age. Let's just keep things so that they're not completely out of line numbers wise. Let's at least, if we want to reduce the senior citizen one, let's at least go back to what we had of $35 instead of going to 20. We've literally gone here to there on all the things that we talked about.
Did we sell some? And I don't think my justification is I don't think it would ever be a bad thing to allow senior citizens to door.
I don't either.
No, I don't. But
it's still functioning. There's still cost associated with it. I don't think you're going to have a senior citizen complain at $35. I don't think they're going to complain at $40. It's still
at $3 each, a senior citizen would have to go 12 times to justify a $35 fee. That was my only thought. If it's only $3 each, $35 is 12 times. That's pretty many times to go to the pool. That was my only justification. If you're not a daily pool goer.
How many senior citizens?
About 14. And that's probably a high number?
16, 14. That looks like typical last couple of years.
9, 7, 12, 14. So I would say 10 is probably a safe number.
So it's a difference in 150 hours in the course of a year, making $20 more.
Or will it draw more in?
That's what I was hoping.
20.
I mean, if you get it for 20, a lot of them may just buy a pass to get it for 20 and come or not come. I don't ever see a problem with senior citizens doing that before.
I don't either. It's still just a cost. It's just cost. We have to hit a number. Most expensive.
I can see it. The residents get 20, right?
Correct.
Why not just 25 then? Just give it a
Well, what you did though was you did make the daily admissions the same.
Made $3 for any senior citizen to get in at any time. So if you're going up $20 for any senior citizen to get a pass.
$150 decision, Chris.
What?
We've got a lot of other stuff to talk about here.
So there's a motion on the floor. It's going to cost $150.
Let's vote. Get it over with.
All right.
Where we are.
Let's vote. All in favor? We have 4 ayes. Opposed? Mr. Barry is opposed.
Do we want to do a military rate?
Yes.
So we got non-resident. We eliminated East Penn, right?
And then you need to decide whether it's just daily rates.
How does a military person show that they're on active duty, has a special ID?
They have
but then if you, once you...
You are, still have a...
You still keep that? So with military ID. Don't you want to say?
Well,
so we give.
I don't have a problem mimicking senior citizens for.
Do we need to do a daily rate too?
Should.
Okay.
Yeah, I would think so.
I don't have a problem mimicking senior citizens. So you military mean, personnel with ID.
You're going to be cutting your revenues probably so.
I think that's going to be a deep cut.
Military?
I do.
For like a season pass?
You're not just talking about. Is active duty. You're talking about anybody that's ever been on a discharge from the military. It's just something that you've got to think about that. I mean,
like my dad was in the military. He wouldn't have an ID and get a military discount though. I don't know. He doesn't have a military ID.
Sure. But you're talking about anybody that served in the reserves for 4 years and got out.
Okay, that's different then.
Well, let's make it active duty then. That way, because if they're home for leave, they can go swimming and get at least a daily rate.
I agree. Let's do active. That's a good one.
And only do it for daily? Do it daily? I can't see an active duty buy-in season pass, so.
We don't have a barracks anywhere
around here. Would that be something?
We can sell them some property.
Yeah.
So what would be the daily rate for, they'd be an adult, 18 and over, they have to be. So the daily rate now is, what did we put it at? I have $7.
You made it $3 for senior citizens?
It could be active duty.
I'll make a motion active duty for residents,
yes.
So this military rate goes just for residents?
Yes.
With the valid ID?
Yeah.
Yep.
With military ID.
Discussion? All in favor?
Get a second.
Mr. Schultz, a second.
What was the
five? Yeah. Okay, we have a moment. He's been half an hour and he's full. He's going to be here.
Yeah, we're late.
20 minutes.
Once it's solved.
Now, do we have
Pavilions?
Yeah,
I'm
going to
do Pavilions.
No, you have concession stand.
Pavilion now.
I think our pavilion numbers were directly reflected.
I think weather.
By weather, I agree. But the thing is.
Yeah, swimming pool. Maybe.
Most people reserve the pavilions months and months ahead of time.
Can you?
I think the swimming pool rate really affected.
Can you pull up the pavilion rental?
Yeah, and the other thing I think you're going to see is that I don't think the numbers were off that bad.
We didn't go crazy.
Pavilion rentals, we didn't lose that much.
Yeah, I think if anything, because we did adjust them, but do you remember what our adjustment was? It wasn't
non-residents, but it wasn't. We went from like it's 100 for a resident to have it during the week, but it's 150 for a non-resident, which I don't think is unreasonable. Remember we talked about like 300 for non-residents, and then we would have been...
Yeah, so actually our number actually went up in
rental?
In rental. Oh, it did look.
But if you look at by the day...
During the week, we could make them cheaper to have more people, but I don't know... If one cheaper than $40 is going to serve us any benefit, I mean, it takes you're at least investing an hour of time to do the work along with gas and supplies to clean a pavilion.
So weekdays, pavilion rentals are $40 for residents and $75 for non-residents.
And I don't see a problem with
that. Did we raise that from the year before?
What the?
I think we actually dropped it.
You dropped it, yeah.
And what I was going to say, and I thought that's what we did, I just couldn't remember, is I think that one of the things we should do is maybe look over the last 5 years, and we have the names and addresses of the people that rented, and just send out a mail. Because a lot of those things are annual. I mean, I even have someone, an employee of mine, that said that their family, for years, did their family reunion at the community park, and about 3 years ago decided to stop doing it because they felt the cost was prohibitive to that. They always liked the park. They said they wish they could come back. They just wanted to save a few dollars. So if we somehow mailed them, just
I agree. I think that's a very good idea. Reach out to them and say, hey, pool rates are down, pavilions are available.
Well,
here's
the 2013 number by day.
There's Friday.
Fridays are
too big to be using them. But.
It's hump day. That must be it.
Here's your. I can tell you what pavilion we rented on what day and what month.
I think pavilion rates are fine. I think we try it with the reduced pool rates and see if that affects it.
Yeah, I don't think that's right.
Making pavilions much cheaper, I don't know that it's going to affect
it. Here's your revenue chart.
Except, are we going to go with not renting for an stand?
That's
your geese.
No, that goes to your committee.
Time.
That goes to your committee.
Wes won't let me shoo him away. He likes tropical food.
Yeah. I have a suggestion from one citizen to shoot him and give people the meat to the homeless.
Does
anyone make a motion to?
What?
For Burn Stamp.
Whatever you want with Burn Stamp. This year until we figure out.
You had. Now, before you go anywhere there, Furnace Dam was rented 15 times.
How many times did you read about them?
Twice.
Only twice?
Yes.
Really?
So let it ride.
Let it ride then, I guess. I thought it was a
lot
you
want to do
more
something
than that.
I have no problems not renting that and making it free use to the public.
I seriously have issues with that.
Yeah,
disturbing as it is. I'll make a motion not to charge to rent.
Are you still going to take reservations?
No. No.
I don't want people in it, period. Not until we figure out how to keep it clean. It's a health issue. I'm sorry.
Is there a second to Mrs. Gilbert's motion not to rent Furnace Stamp, not take reservations?
No.
I'll second it for discussion.
I agree with that it's filthy, but I mean, we had 15 rentals. I agree. We have 15 only had two refunds, something. I thought we had at least more than that. At least half were refunded, but I guess I'm wrong.
A little over $1,000.
Yeah. If somebody wants to rent it,
if they want to use it, I have a problem with you going in there on your own rent, but I don't want to charge somebody to do that.
He'll walk through there and you'll see it. It's absolutely gross. I mean, there's 100 geese.
We're getting a lot of trouble.
Today there is. Oh, yeah.
So last week there's 100 geese there. You walk through there, it's
somebody sent out an
invite. It's
like
unbelievable.
So we're talking about the budget. Then let's budget to get rid of the geese. It is a revenue source. So at
I would say keep that in budget to get rid of the geese.
So what did the pavilion
14 times 75. So $750 plus $300, $1050 plus another $40, $1,100.
So $1,100. I mean, it's not a great one, but it also again has a stigma.
You just got to buy the bolts.
Hey, guys, we know that it's a health issue out
there.
Suppose somebody really gets seriously ill and we end up getting sued. We're going to be paying more than
$1,100.
It's going to
be a lot more than
$1,100.
In 3 hours first, in an hour now.
I mean, I just
the call
literally
have
just a phone call.
All right, other discussion on the Furnace Stamp Pavilion?
Can we make it that, can we clean up?
Well, we have a motion right now, so.
Okay. Motion is not to use it at all.
And motion is not to take reservations and not to charge money if someone wants to use it.
Open to the public.
Whatever you want to do.
At their own risk.
Absolutely.
But do they still have to let us know that they're there? We don't?
I don't want to know they're there.
I think that's most bad though.
Not knowing that someone's there. Well, it's a park, I mean, we don't have people reserve the playground.
We still have a pavilion and picnic tables.
Well, maybe you're taking, maybe take all the picnic table out. I'm serious.
Maybe you're taking the pavilion and move it?
I was thinking about it. We could, that's a good point.
I mean, I think you're probably still open to the same kind of concern.
Are you viable if you just let people come out of the park?
Well, if somebody comes in and sits at a table on the hill and eats their lunch.
We put up a big sign that says, "Don't eat the goose poop."
That might not work.
All right, well, all in favor of the motion to not take reservations and not rent for a stamp? Two in favor, those opposed? Barry, Waddell, and Chuck Star opposed.
On the record, I warned you.
I know, I'm on the fence, I live there, I know.
All right, concession stand operations. I see you have that on here.
I'll catch
up. Do you have a plan you're bringing forward, or are you just looking for our input on what we would like to do?
I think I have a plan.
I don't know, I'm coming
in. You thought you had
I know there's plenty of room there, but you're asking about the whole Peppy operation down there. Peppy's Pizza.
I get some t-shirts. We can make
I will move my entire desk and computer down there. I'll stay down there all year.
I'll make a motion we do want to get down to the...
What's that? Yes.
All right. So what is the plan for the concessions?
I think
we over budget.
Well, I agree. I think the new budget probably reflects...
Where is it?
It's the one I can use. My thought is, let's try one more year and see how it goes with somebody else, hopefully different.
Yes.
Operating, I've already interviewed someone.
Okay.
Get a school teacher.
Somebody that works in the school district that orders their food.
Good.
I think we should try one more year. My thought is,
I don't want to give up on LSU.
Yeah. It was a failure last year, but
we put money into it, so let's put try and get some money back out of it.
So.
Talk about that.
Well, I think it's maybe part of this, and you mentioned, alluded to before, having somebody manage the three areas, the pool, the concession stand, and the summer program. You know, take some of the monies that we had and make a little bit better salary and find one person or persons who could oversee the whole operation down there for the summer. I think we need to do that. I think we need to have an adult who's not a 20-something that's worked with these kids. A true adult to manage that down there. I think we can do okay with it.
I agree. I think it's going to be persons. When thinking about the amount of time...
Too much time.
Right.
You have to be...
I think that if we had two 40-hour per week people, because essentially the lifeguard pool manager job is a 40-hour job, and a 40-hour week concession stand / summer park, program, I think we could do that, but we've got to have the right two people. I mean, that's the important thing. That's definitely the important thing.
Absolutely.
I have one. I'll make a suggestion for somebody at the right tarmac next year. I have someone that can do a very good job with that.
Well, we need to have somebody that's trained in food service, but somebody that's trained in pool management. So it can't be just the local English teacher. It needs to be somebody that has those skills, because you know, the food service part of it is just as important as the swimming pool safety part. So
your wages for a pool manager reflect that?
$12 an hour is what they reflect.
Is that just for one person for dinner?
Which is what it was last year. No, that was concession stand manager, I'm sorry. Pool manager was...
And then bonus at the end, correct?
So depending on the performance, it's $2,000 possible bonus.
Right, which didn't.
Right, but it's budgeted.
Right.
So I have in my mind that it was $10,000.
It is $10,000. That's what your budget was. That's what our budget is.
Okay, thank you.
If they get the bonus.
Do you think it's right about that?
And that's going to be the same under your scenarios here?
Okay.
I said your pool manager definitely puts in more than 40 hours a week.
Go ahead.
For how many weeks?
10 full weeks. 10 to 11.
So keeping both of those concessions.
No, I brought your concession stand wages down.
Well, you had three people in there.
Which, depending on who's managing it, yeah, I can't.
I don't understand how you have three.
Here's what we budgeted for. We budgeted for two people at a time in that stand during the week, and on the weekends, three. All right, that's what our budget showed. We were well within that budget. So, what she ended up scheduling, I don't know. I mean, I told you before, I'm guilty of that's the last thing that was on my mind. Unfortunately, now it's not. So.
So this. The budget you have is 18.
Which is, yeah, because we spent 17 last year.
Okay.
For the, now, that 21,120 that we budgeted was if that pool, or if that stand was open every day, we staffed it with two people during the week, all day, three people on the weekend, all day, plus the manager's salary, we would have spent $21,120. Instead, we spent $17,105. Right. Which is what we.
Are you comfortable at 18? If you want to go up there.
You should probably bump to 20 if it's going to be. If it's sunny out most of the summer, then we're going to spend more on wages.
Put the extra in there.
Yeah, I would put the extra in. But also, I mean, if we've cut our rates and the theory is that that's going to bring more people to the pool, all these numbers.
But, yeah, and you know, one of the things too is the pool manager could schedule, or the concession stand manager could schedule himself in there with one other person as well. That's not how it was ran last year.
Correct. No. There were three people scheduled on, and we were paying.
And the manager.
And the manager. Right. So,
let's increase that to
just make 20. I'd make it 20 to be safe. But that is trusting in the fact that we're going to have someone good who's going to move product, and we're not going to be left with.
Well, let's
increase
it for now and see where we are.
Hey,
let's
Thursday.
Somebody
don't want
it
in your house.
We sold everything.
Yeah, we sold it all.
We sold it all.
Go
ahead and
what's that? No. All right, so take care of your concession stand. You know the direction to go and how to make that work. All right, so personnel questions.
Yeah, we're getting to bullet three. Jeez. 1 hour.
We're
good.
We're
going.
So,
I got wrestling at 6 hours.
2013, we cut three positions, so we're full-time. One was the assistant DPW director, one was a full-time paramedic that wasn't hired this year, one was a full-time public works employee. 2013, we also cut back on part-time police, park police, downtown officer, seasonal DPW, and fire department labor. Question is, are more cuts needed? That's something that we need to decide at the end of this budget. We're proposing that the full-time police officer, and we'd like to actually get some feedback from you right now.
Mm-hmm.
Two full-time police officers versus one full-time police officer. Because we interview tomorrow.
So he's retiring, right?
But yeah, so Vicky, you know we've been trying to hire somebody for over 2 years now.
Yeah.
Yep. We're finally at a point where we have a final three.
It's going to go wrong in the head.
No.
Yeah, right.
If we go for two, maybe we'll get one.
No.
We know that Vicky Schaefer is retiring September 6th or 7th of next year.
Yep.
One person out of the final three is an ACT 120 certified candidate, which means they can start tomorrow. They're not number one or number two.
Technically,
no,
but
so,
maybe.
Right.
Well,
there's more to it than that too. So no matter what, your other person, which by the way, your number one candidate is not Act 120 qualified and is probably very well qualified.
no matter what, if you hire somebody that's not Act 120 qualified, they will start school in February. They'll be in school through July. They'll get on their field training mid-July. They won't even start on the road until September when she retires. So, ta-da, we have another opening. And we're starting over. Which, by the way, if we start over when she retires, they still wouldn't go back to school until February, which means we wouldn't have them on the road until September of next year.
It would take longer than that because the list is only good for a year, so the commission would have to start the process all over again.
So we're starting this year, or you're happy on it.
Okay.
So two police. It makes the most sense to go.
Why I would like a motion for you guys.
I'll make a motion that we hire two full-time police officers in this budget.
I'll second. Any other discussion?
We're currently down to one, right?
Yes. I'm hiring the second and the replace in
to replace officer
Schaefer. Schaefer when she
retires. She'll be retired.
Which the person will be coming off of FTO training right when she's retired.
If not, then we go through the whole 1 year process and try and hire somebody starting in September. What impact would that have on overtime, having two in the pipeline?
I would say...
it's always a killer.
Yes.
Your overtime...
Well...
Your overtime budget's not going to be affected any worse than it is right now. Once you get that new person on, let's say you hire two, and one of them is the Act 120 certified person, overtime's actually going to go down. Probably... It's not going to go down proportionally, though, and that's where people make the perception that it will. It won't. You hire a full-time person to become fully staffed, I would say your overtime budget is going to go down conservatively 15,000. Okay. I would think, I wouldn't estimate any more than that, though. All right. But when you look at all the open shifts that get filled because there's nobody there, I think you're going to save us probably $15,000 in overtime costs.
Right.
I think $15,000 is probably a good guess.
Thank you.
All right, all in favor of two police officers? Five ayes.
So we're going to be interviewing for...
Lee, we're going to...
We have a list of three. So
we have to hire one.
Then we have to ask the commission for another name.
Like they gave, let me see what they gave us. I think they gave us a list of four.
They certified a list of four, but only gave us three names.
So you probably hire one, and then we'll go back and interview again and hire you
with that. But at least the process is moving, we're not waiting.
But
moving,
don't forget, this person needs to pass the polygraph, psychological, and physical evaluation.
The polygraph is the hardest out of the entire 8-month process. Should be.
Being honest, is that hard?
Yeah, so we typically throw out 3 out of 5, and that's across the board, Pennsylvania.
So,
probably 3 out of 5 are going in the state police is what they're telling us. So
at least Monday you'll get a name that we can hopefully move forward with.
Now we feel like we've done our officers have done such a good background check that I think we're to the point where the three candidates that we have in there, we should have done enough homework. But it's what they admit, not what they lie about. That's the crazy thing about polygraph. They'll actually, because they're so afraid of lying, they'll admit to, yes, I dealt drugs last September. You know, and you're like, what? Where the heck did that come from? But that's really where they get caught up is what they tell you the truth about. Rather than what they're actually called lying about. Which is good, because then we don't have to sit there and...
Then you turn it off and you're done.
All right,
full
time. Coming down your list. All right, so the question of a full-time paramedic position. It is not budgeted yet. However, it was this past year. All right, you need to decide...
So the wages aren't there for
another? The wages are not there for. We left it out of the budget. That doesn't mean, that's why I have highlighted and have 4 stars inside it, because we need you to decide whether or not.
And that's 40,100 is about, a little bit more than that now, about 40,000 more.
It was 247,527 last year, and now it will be 2,000.
It's like 47.
Go to Mike's, go to the ambulance and look at Mike's proposed wages.
254 increase.
Okay.
But what did we increase? We increased wages last year. In what?
We increased wages in over here they are right here.
No, we specifically increased wages. Was that for?
That was for
paramedic.
Yep. That was for.
So from 12 to 13, we increased 30,000.
No, we had increased. No, we didn't. We actually decreased for paramedic, planning that we were going to hire, but it wasn't going to be at Donna's rate. But we had increased significantly for part-time EMTs.
But we didn't hire.
But we didn't.
No, either. Did we?
But we did. But the issue was that wasn't the number that we should have had, and that was why, as of Friday, we're $8,000 over on that budget. So the question.
I'm under the other.
Yeah. Yeah, you're definitely going to be under here on full time. So the question is, are we or aren't we going to hire another full time paramedic? If you are, does this number go down, Mike?
Should drop some.
So what's the justification, Mike? I don't know the situation.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, there's, you know, the problem filling shifts with the fifth person, you know, we have more flexibility. It's like, you know, you put the additional person on there, then you can move them around to different shifts. What I had proposed last year was 135 for part-time, which is what we actually need to fill the shifts 24/7 with the part-time individuals. Now, obviously, if you hire that fifth person or the additional paramedic, that's going to take up shift time. So that 135 could go back to the 110. So, you know, you're not going to realize a full, you know, amount of wages because of, you know, staffing needs.
How are we doing on the revenue side to justify that?
No.
Here's your revenue for. Nice to see you join.
Well, somebody would call me earlier.
Here you are for.
Look at how smiley.
That's poor guy.
Hourly Rory.
Well,
at least
that
taxi
dude.
Well, then.
He's
your buddy.
So where are we revenue-wise? So ambulance, third party as of Friday, you were at 462,000 out of 625. That is on pace with the typical 555-535 that you had budgeted in the past. If you look, that's what we're budgeting next year is 550. All right. You are not going to be anywhere close to meeting your budget.
Next year's revenue for ambulance is down how much as compared to what we planned for this year?
80,000?
75,000, which is what you increased it.
Okay. So next year,
it would be $3,000 over. No, it would be $10,000 under what we budgeted for 2012, it'd be $3,000 over what we actually brought in 2012.
And expenses would go up how much for next year? I think it was like 27, but what are they?
Overall expenses? We're looking at $658,000. Your 2013 budget was 665,000.
So it would be up.
You're going to jump
it up 20,000 plus benefits. What would benefits? Another.
I mean, for a family. 21,000.
So it would be, we'd be going up 40,000 in expenses and down 75,000 in revenue. So it'd be $115,000 extra.
Wow.
Am I correct? Am I thinking? Well, revenue's down 75,000.
No. If you're going off budget numbers, no, you're wrong. You're not right. Because this year, we had the wages budget for the full-time position.
Okay.
So if we're going to use, we got to use either budget numbers or actual numbers, but we got to use from that same column, not actual here and budgeted there. We budgeted for the expense of the full-time person in 2013. We did not hire him.
Okay.
Instead, he used more part-time EMT labor, which is why we pushed over there.
So
but
let's,
your labor here in full-time is down. Okay.
So let's go back to the full-time budgeted figure. 247.
It's actually it would be 254, 742 for 2014.
So we're increasing 7,000 there from this year.
Right.
Plus 21,000 in benefits.
Correct.
So we'd be increasing $28,000 from this year. No. No. We budgeted the benefits too for this year.
The benefits are already.
Everything is this year in 2013. Everything's budgeted for 2013. 2014, we took it out because, well, we didn't hire. All right, so the question is, do we keep on going the same path as keep on paying for part-time wages, or are we going to actually hire next year, in which case I have to adjust next year's numbers back up. All right, now.
So what if we budgeted the 247,000 for wages for full-time? And then reduce your part-time EMT wages back down to 110.
Right. Yeah, you can do that.
But he couldn't meet 247 because they need the increase and because of the increases that people need.
It's 250, whatever, it's 250.
You know what I mean? It would be 247 plus the increase, so you need 254 there. Make sense?
Yeah.
So he'd need 254 there, but then you're gonna drop 25,000 there, and then you're already, benefits you've already dropped or you budgeted?
We already dropped.
So then we're going to have to add that back in.
Add in the benefits.
So bottom line is going to change by 47 minus 22 plus 20, 44, and revenue is already down 75,000 for next year?
Budgeted, yes.
Okay, budgeted. So that's already done. So we're going to see a net increase of $44,000 in the bottom line.
That's
a positive. Yeah, I mean it's the number's higher.
Yes.
Well, our expenses are going to be 44,000 more. Now, without the full time laborer, your budget is budgeted to be actually less than this year's budget.
Right.
Okay.
Our revenue is considerably less, also.
Absolutely.
Which is how it has to be. If revenue is going down, expenses have to go down.
But the increase in the revenue was based on the $75,000 or $80,000 increase for the transport.
Correct. But without that transport happening and us not seeing that revenue, I don't foresee us being able to increase expenses. I don't see us being able to increase expenses without increasing revenue.
I think that's why I asked the question. Can we afford this position? I think I'm hearing is we're going to lose more money if we add a position. Unless somehow more revenue. So I'm not sure how we can justify that. Am I missing something here, Chief?
Well, I'm just trying to figure, I'm looking at my budget, the budget that I submitted was the 254.
Right.
Okay. And it did have the 135. You decrease from 135 to 110, so that's a $25,000 net decrease in the expenses. And if you take that off the 710,760, it's going to put you at 185 or 685, which is about a 3%, probably 3% increase over expenses that would occur this year.
Plus, then your benefits have to be added in. They don't go directly in your line.
Right,
demand
the line
benefits right. Have to go into our overall picture. We have 21,000 benefits added in.
So tell me what you want to do.
Well, we can't do can't pay for itself, how can we justify putting it in? That's how I see it.
And unfortunately, that's the nature of the ambulance corps, that you generate revenue, which other departments don't.
Your net.
It shouldn't be punishment to generate revenue.
Well, your net taxpayer expense on ambulance is only like $160,000. They're actually probably the cheapest department.
I agree. Yeah. Let it ride till next time. Unless you have a motion over me.
You know what?
I haven't spoken to Rachel.
Why don't we figure it in for now and see where we are come Thursday? Look at the numbers overall.
How about we let this ride until Thursday?
I agree.
Let's you and I talk between now and Thursday and run some numbers and some reasons why we may or may not need this position. And that way we can come back to you on Thursday.
That's fine.
That's a more educated opinion.
Deeper discussion.
I agree. And I owe that to the chief to hear that too. You're right with that, Chief, if we wait and do nothing at the moment.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
I should say that, yes.
Sure.
The kids.
Okay. All right.
Be back Thursday.
Fire department has asked for an increase. And I would just suggest that we discuss this. Use your word twice.
And the requested increase is?
Up to $172,000.
Which was the previous standby. We cut $20,000 out of standby, and they're asking for
their money back.
Now, here's what I'm going to tell you. Remember, this is what it's going to look like on paper. I really don't care what you do there. But if you reduce that, then this number goes down by that amount. If you increase that, then you understand what I'm saying?
So the number, the fire on paper number is not reflective of the yellow number?
Yeah, it does. It is reflective of
it. Okay.
Because all it is, it's reflective of the bottom line. So if you reduce anything here, it'll reduce
what
it actually show on paper. Okay.
And right now in our budget, you're showing the...
Right now, the only discussion I really want to have is...
You're showing the requested number.
That's what I want to talk about right now. Okay.
Let me see that fire on paper.
It would actually go into this number right here. That's the number that would do.
This old one is just you took that...
Right.
You got the relief and put it above.
Got it. Okay. That's why you see such a drastic thing in the difference in those. So the question is, do you give them the $20,000 back or do you tell them a little of what they got?
Comment?
I needed input on that.
We didn't have any fires that we couldn't fight in 2013, correct? But we didn't have fires that we couldn't put people on the fire with the reduction that we gave them.
You do have your fire chief in the room.
No.
I just put the zero on.
No.
Watch it. Don't start zeroing. So, chief, why would if we could effectively fight our fires, why would we pay $20,000 more next year?
Well, it's I don't know how to answer that. We've had some reduction in calls and.
Let me ask you a question. With the 127 we budgeted?
No, we budgeted
152. The 152, did we still have three persons on call each evening? Chief.
The issue was during the day, right, Jim?
The issue was during the day. Basically, what happened this year is we had some open shifts, not necessarily nobody there, but we may have only had two people on, so we sort of did resolve that problem, but we like to go back to the full three-man shifts.
Okay.
data questions. The number, so we see 127,000. That's the answer.
That's what we spent. That's what they spent so far a year to date.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, so 152, right?
Right. So there'll be two more payrolls. So we'll probably get to approximately
10 payrolls in there.
And so what would you expect the number?
At 24,000, they'll hit 152 exactly, right?
Yeah, I think they have a plan.
I think they have it planned out that they'll hit. So the number we give them is the number they hit.
They're backing out.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
They are that good when we give them a budgeted number, meeting the budgeted number.
Right.
Okay. No, that's good.
So if we gave them 172 next year, they'd hit 172. But they did it on 152 this year.
Right, well, that's what I'm trying to understand. I mean, I didn't see something there that was going to be an additional payment that was going to put this way over. It stayed within check.
Was there an issue? Was there any issue with our public works people helping out on an actual call?
No.
We didn't run into any problems that people, John Rice or Cliff,
no,
or those couldn't be there?
What would happen is that John would call me and ask me if they were needed. If I called for a second alarm, they would respond right away. If they were not doing anything like blacktopping or anything else and couldn't leave, you know, John would tell me if he could leave or not. There was no problem with the...
And no problems from the public works
end at that setup?
No, we haven't had any kind of real, you know, if we're 8 feet in the ground trying to fix a water leak,
right?
You know, and John Rice is the guy that's trying to
turn
the
job,
and the bell rings, you know, we've got an emergency here, an emergency there. He's probably gonna, unless something's burning,
right.
Unless he's gonna keep working on it. Right? I mean, but how often does that happen? You know, your chances are probably 1 in 300 calls of that happening.
And
just only got 400 a year. So.
Right. And you mentioned that the calls were down. Can you give a percentage or even just an actual hard number?
Well, right now we're approximately 300 calls,
okay.
Calls per year. You know, we still got month and a half to go. So that's about 6 weeks. So we're probably going to be right to where we are normally are, around 350, but maybe a little bit more than that.
Okay. So the change in the way that some of the calls were responded to at the high rise did not change. My understanding is that the calls did change. That's not
the,
true.
Yeah. So taking out the game well and going with the alarm systems the way they are now, the alarms did. Significantly go down for the high rises.
Yeah. I mean, that was good because that was a lot of kind of wasted energy. It wasn't really responding to a call that.
Yeah, well, the architect thought it was a waste, but we didn't think it was a waste. And they said, well, you're the only fire company in the area that does that. Everybody else, you know, so I guess now we're with everybody else now. Yeah.
I mean, it seems like it's more efficient now. Is that accurate?
Well, what has to happen is that the two smoke detectors have to go off at the same time for us to be notified.
Yeah.
So if one smoke detector goes off and they take care of the problem, then we're not going to be notified. And that has significantly dropped.
Yeah, I mean, that seems true. I mean, instead of sending a whole crew to something that's really a non-emergency.
Yeah. No, and a lot of times it was basically a three people on shift that were going. It wasn't 20 guys.
They were already paid, yeah.
Unless there was a major problem, which you might have had three to six problems in the time that they're here.
You need to take a turn in the legal.
That makes sense.
Recommendations from council?
I think for now we have to leave it to one. We're going to have to be lean, and we have to go through
it. I think every department would have
to. Just want to Thursday, again, look at the numbers again and see where we are on Thursday.
So Dr. Waddell recommends 152. You want a motion to that effect?
I don't think I need a motion.
Okay. Well, it's at 172 now.
You want to make it 152?
Yes, please. We'll keep our eyes on that.
I hope so. I I usually get the formulas right sometimes. Next. Dave is thinking at the end of next year, and I don't know that we're ready to talk about that yet.
End of 2014, you're saying? That's 20, that says 2013.
I mean 2014, I'm sorry.
Okay. That's promotions of
turning people into corporals. To start thinking about a succession plan for some of the aging sergeants.
Okay.
For a rank structure.
Yeah.
And that costs us money?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In 2015?
Probably, yeah. So it's something to start thinking about for the end of next year.
Okay, if he wants to come present that to us early in 2014, when we have a budget meeting early in 2014, if he wants to come and present.
I put it in there because I don't think he's really talked to anybody formally about it.
Okay.
It's something to kind of put in your mind.
Public safety or the budget planning?
I don't even know if he's ready to go that deep.
He and I have had conversations.
Okay.
As long as you're in the loop, that's fine.
I'm
whatever he wants to. If he wants to come to a budget finance meeting at any time, that's fine.
Okay, so the next item. The question of how to fund the fire department has continuously been questioned by a committee from the fire department that has been negotiating and working on the ordinance, as well as council members. In one of the suggestions that came up, and to be honest with you, I am absolutely 100% in favor of this. So, what's your decision? Is to separate the fire department into a fire tax fund. You would lower your general fund millage by the amount that you create for the fire tax millage. Essentially, the taxpayer pays $500 a year. Taxes, they'd still be paying $500 a year, but you'd be creating a fire tax on top of the general fund tax. Do you understand what I'm saying? So
basically what everybody is paying now, they continue to pay, but it would be split out
between general
and fire.
And what that does, and one of the biggest concerns of the firemen, is how can we be guaranteed that we're going to get funded next year? And if we don't spend it, what are you going to do with it? You're going to give it to public works, police, ambulance? Because we are turning them into a volunteer fire department, our own entity, I think a fire fund would play perfectly to this. So let's just give a theoretical, you have a 10 mil property, which are just 4 points, some goofy number. Let's just say you have a 10 mil property tax. Right now it's 10 mils, you get all these services for it. What would happen is, you would separate out fire department, so you would now have a 9 mil general fund tax and a 1 mil fire tax to be a combined 10 mils. The 1 mil can only be spent on fire. All right, you're not allowed to take that money and spend it on water or sewer or anything else. The money that goes into that fire is forever spent on fire, okay? It's just like your water fund. You're only allowed to spend water fund money on water services. So there's two theories behind it. One is, okay, it definitely would better define, here's the money that comes in for fire. This is it. This is the fire tax, this is the fire fund, boom, there it is. The other philosophy, and I'm sure some of you are sitting there saying it, and I completely understand that too, and that is, are you just creating another tax burden for our residents to pay? Sure, I understand that argument. My counter argument is, yeah, but they're paying the same amount of money. It's just that now what we're doing is we're separating it completely out of the general fund budget, and we're making it its own separate budget. You know, heck, they're already becoming their own separate entity. And a certain millage is now dedicated just for their operation.
Taxes collected in the same way, just...
Taxes, you're going to get the same tax bill.
Still managed here,
yeah.
Or just same and then passed to the fire department.
Same way. Yep, same one.
I think it's a great idea because I think it solidifies their ability to know that they'll be funded to a certain level.
It absolutely does. The other thing it does is, you know, some of them want to play games. You have to spend legal costs in fire. It comes out of the fire fund. If you have wages in fire, it comes out of the wages fund. If you have an insurance increase in fire, it comes out of the fire fund.
If you're buying a piece of fire apparatus, it comes out of the fire fund. And that doesn't mean that you can't take capital fund money or general fund expenses and throw them towards it. You're allowed to do that. You can spend general fund money on essentially anything. But there it is. Now, that is the only fund, as far as departments that we have, that you're allowed to create a separate fund and tax. But it's something that can be easily set up. It's not difficult to set up. You pass it by ordinance. It's easy for us to set up. Our accounting system is probably the most difficult thing to do because now we're turning it into a fund. Fire department comes totally is eliminated out of the general fund. We have to create fund number 09 or fund whatever fund inside it is. And it's its own fund, its own tax.
So the two factors, what is the procedure that we would do to get to actually create this tax? And then what is the agent that determines the rate? And how does that change? Is it on a yearly basis? Is it?
Yeah, so what you do is you pass by ordinance. So really on December 2nd, 3rd, whatever it is, when I introduce your preliminary budget, I'm going to introduce the first reading of your fire tax ordinance. Okay. On December 16th, on December 16th, what we're looking at there is, here it is, it's been properly advertised, it's up for a vote of council. All right, now, once you pass it, my job is to send it to the tax assessment office. Here are our millage rates. So now, our millage went down from 10 mils to 9 mils for general, but fire is now 1 mil. And really, the numbers are more 4.325 and 0.1 or 0.2.
Yeah.
It's that easy.
So the number is always proportionate to what our millage rate,
the amount
that you get. So for me to decide what the millage rate will be, I decide simply based on what's our expense for the fire department. Right. If our expense from the fire department is $451,827, I take that, divide that number into our expected revenue per mil, which I have it in here somewhere. We're right on the money as far as it's like $727,000 or something like that. So you're looking at two-thirds of a mil, whatever the decimal number comes in at. That's what that number would be for your fire department.
That can change.
It's just like your regular property. It's just like your regular property tax.
So it's identical. If you're going to change the millage of tax, you can change the millage of that tax.
Yeah. So now everything that you do with it is just like when you would change property taxes. If I'm changing the millage, if I'm increasing millage in fire, I have to do it by ordinance. Buyer millage can only go up to 3 mils. Now, if you spend 3 mils in fire department, we've got a major problem this time. All right? Because you're talking about $2.3 million or something like that.
Four mils is?
It's 3 mils times 780,000 or something like that. So we're talking about almost $3 million bucks. You should never get that.
What are you looking for us? A motion to create?
I would ask for a motion to allow me to create an ordinance if that's what you want to do. All right, I told you, I am 100% biased on that. So take that for what it's worth. I mean, I am 100% in favor of doing it, but you guys, it doesn't affect me one way or the other at the end of the day. So whatever you decide, I don't think it's going to do obviously.
I'll make a motion. Have you draft an ordinance for the fire tax, and let's see where it goes under discussion.
I'll second that. Discussion.
You can discuss on
everybody.
You're all here. Workshop. Let's commit.
So would that lower than the donation to the fire department?
No.
There would be no donation. That would just be a part of the tax.
Well, that's what we can do.
Right. But
what it does is, if they don't
spend $451,000 next year, let's say they spend $351,000, that $100,000 gets rolled into next year's money for just the fire department.
Just the fire department.
They
Regardless of which way you do it, though.
No, that's not necessarily. Yeah, that's not necessarily true.
Okay, currently our tax rate is 4.325 mils.
Correct.
1 mil is equivalent to $797,271.67.
Yeah, I want to ask me to give the number again until you guys decide. Go ahead.
Where we are figure wise. So we're looking at half a mil.
Take 451. Take 451 divided by 797. That's what your mill would be. Two thirds, somewhere in there.
0.56.
So that's how you figure it out. And then you take your general fund millage rate and you decrease it by that by 0.56. So people are still going to get
paid the same amount.
A 4.325 mil tax.
Yeah.
You're now breaking out the fire department.
And they'll have a fund like the water fund. They'll be accounted
that way.
We're
not going to cut them a check.
We are. Well, you and
You're
I
still responsible for.
Yeah, I'll get into detail how it would work with you.
Because their accounting will be separate from our accounting.
Because all the tax monies that come into the borough.
Right.
And then you take those.
So when you record tax money from the fire fund part of it, it will go into fire fund. Not our tax, when we get a check from Dennis, it'll be broken down. So if you get $1 million from him, it'll show $750,000 for general fund, $250,000.
But we don't get that money until May, June.
That's correct.
Which gives us 4 or 5 months at the beginning of the year.
Which we'll have to pre-fund it back. Yeah.
And we'll have the money because it'll be budgeted.
For the first year or two, you have to.
It'll just be a little creative in how you're gonna move what how to get into that in time.
So in theory, this promotes more efficiency because whatever is not used does go back to the fire department.
100%
for
fire. Yeah.
Most municipalities do.
I come from a municipality that we did it. Everybody around us did it. Everybody around us here does it. Salisbury does it. I think it was Salisbury. You were giving me, what, six of them? That does it. They're their own entity.
Yeah.
What happens to the fire chief? Is he still our employee then?
Yeah.
Or does he fall under a fire chief?
Nothing changes. No, he would fall under the fire fund. Yeah, he would fall under the fire fund. Their entire budget. Now get pushed to. I would also include their workers' comp insurance, their liability insurance. I'd push it all, take everything for fire, and push it all
more than 0.56 mil. We're going to reduce our entire budget by that number, our general fund, and then move it to
separate. Before we get to the numbers, I think some of the councilmen, I would encourage you to do some other researches of other municipalities of how they're working too as well. For us to give almost $500,000 to a 40-member fire company, I think in my opinion was a little high. I know it might cause a little strife, but I know a lot of municipalities out there are running on $150,000, $200,000, for a volunteer fire department.
Because all this goes away.
Yeah, exactly.
So can I ask you a question? You have, and Shane, you have in there, it's called building maintenance for them, for the fire department.
Yeah, so your fire department, your fire department ordinance that we have on the table right now for you guys, all right, says that the administrator, which is fire chief, fire inspector, which is, by the way, going to be governed by the code enforcement officer,
right?
The clerk, those three are still our employees, okay? Vehicles are still owned by us,
right?
Buildings are still owned by us. Major equipment is still owned by us. Which means we will be responsible for maintaining that out of our funds.
Out of our funds.
That's why you see on the fire on paper, that's how it's actually gonna look in your budget. Okay.
So who authorized the building maintenance?
Our building we always thought.
It's our building.
We always thought.
Yeah, that's what I figured. Okay.
All we did was we took those line items and we kept
them. So if they went to their stipend, they wanted to give extra stipend, and that this ARC ordinance that we just passed, that doesn't hinder them from doing that.
They can do whatever they want.
They can do whatever they want, right?
I mean, you could say, but you could say the next year, guess what? Right. We're not giving you as much money because you're spending it on yourself rather than, you know, on actual fire protection. I mean, really, because they become their own entity, they're only responsible to give you receipts for the taxpayer money that they spent. Okay? We are not going to watch every single dollar as a borough council of what they spend anymore. That's the difference of them being their own entity and them being ours. Whereas I call Jim in every time we go over a line item, you know, because Christine says, hey, Shane, the buzzer came up, we're over. So there's a difference. I mean, basically, we're cutting them a monthly check. Take 269.3 divided by 12. That's what they get every month in terms of a donation.
Right, they manage it. They manage it, and we review that next year.
Yep.
Right, okay, that makes sense.
But what we're going to ask the fire chief is to give us something like this so that we have an idea of budget time, what he's trying to do.
Well, at budget time, or?
Well, at budget time. By law, he has to give me a copy of every receipt that they spend on, you know, taxpayer dollars. I mean, that,
and the ordinance, the fire tax is state defined in how it works.
Correct? Absolutely.
So there are going to be requirements that come with the fire tax that other municipalities are already using and functioning, so it's already a defined thing. It's not like we're reinventing the wheel here. We're taking an idea that's out there and bringing it here to simplify this process.
I think it's a good idea.
If you look at the electronic version that I gave you the PSED budget bulletin.
Yeah.
It's in there.
No, I think
all right, there's a motion on the floor. Any other discussion? All in favor of Shane creating the ordinance? We have five ayes. Sorry, six ayes. Mr. Brown, sure. But thank you. Thank you for all that research and that effort, Mr. Pepe. I think that'll benefit all of us.
Well, and also, I have to give credit to Nate, too, because Nate did forward me some information as well. So, you know, you have to throw him a ball once in a while.
Hey, I know Brent doesn't want to do that. Yeah, you want to sleep tonight.
Brian
wants to sleep tonight.
Well, yeah.
Brent got
him on that. Brother. By the way, Leanne's the one that started it. So.
All right, 10th Street Culvert.
Yeah, so what do you want to do next year? I mean,
build a bridge. Well, no, there are no bridges.
Got to be fixed.
I like his idea of the concrete.
It's a major project. They're doing one in Wellsboro right now. I was looking at it. It is a major project.
Spray concrete?
That's what, no, they're not spraying. They're putting a new one in, and that was
huge.
Really?
The spray concrete, I don't know. Oh, I think I'd like the committee to hear from an engineer.
Well, the engineer is the one that...
I know, they suggested it, but shouldn't the engineer come in and say to a committee,
yeah,
this is how it works,
here's
so
the
somebody can ask.
He gave us basically three options. All three options were the same price.
Okay,
so it doesn't matter which way we do it. It's still going to cost you $145,000.
Even ripping it out was the same? I thought it was cheaper to spray it than rip it out.
Yeah, if you rip it out and build a concrete bridge, you're right. It's $250,000.
Oh, there you go.
But that wasn't one of his. That wasn't one of his three options.
Oh, okay.
That was one of our questions.
It's got to be done before the road falls in and the car goes with.
But are you going to budget on? My question for you is, are we going to budget the full amount next year and do it?
Why don't you just spend patching it all last year and try to fix it?
We spent somewhere around, I don't know, 8 tons of asphalt from clean fill.
You know what? We're pushing the can down the road again, so we got a budget to fix it.
Yeah, it'll be one of our vehicles that goes in the hole with it.
To budget it and get it done.
The ambulance goes down in there and we're done.
Make sure it's truck 12.
Seriously, a big truck goes in there, though. I mean, the way that falls, I think it's got to be done sooner rather than later.
John said it was collapsing.
It is, constantly.
When you drive over it.
All right, nice. So...
Do you want a motion to fund that? To budget it?
I would say yes.
I would like
it. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Mr. Schultz. Second by Mr. Schultz. Discussion.
And we're funding it
but not determining what
which method yet.
Right. It basically, we know it's going to be about $145,000. Yeah.
But I do think an engineer should speak to Public Works Committee at least so they can ask the questions and come up with the best solution. Aren't you on all committees anyway? All in favor? Six eyes. Dump truck, lease or buy?
Lease.
Buy.
What?
2-1 you lost at committee level.
How's that work, Shane? You said buy for $1 at 10?
Yeah, so vehicle lease gives you $1 option.
And that was your low interest lease?
1.9
was fine. 0.9,
that's fine. And I think I gave you guys
gave us the information.
Sorry. And just as a refresher, because I probably came out, I left at the end of the last one for the Public Works. I don't know. Is that what we talked about?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the idea is, how long do we currently keep trucks?
Well, our one's 1990.
20 is our cycle, though?
Or well, it should be 10 to 15.
Yeah, it should be 10, but our,
I get it. I mean, like, what are we really doing? Are we
we're 24 now.
Yeah.
Anywhere from 20 to 25.
At least 15 on the problem. Yeah. We can get something that
we can. So the lease is for how many years?
I would say only 3.
Lease it.
Okay. Yeah, my suggestion.
So you would lease it at 1.9%. It means that we don't put the same amount of capital up, and then the option to buy at the end.
Well, it's on automatic.
You're on the automatic. Dollar. We'll just budget it over the course of 3 years with a 1.9%.
So it'd be about $52,000 a year.
Instead of $145,000 right up front, right?
Right.
And your thinking is that, well, you don't have to put as much up.
Well, yeah, my only thinking is it's 1.9%. And you're not going to eat $150,000 today. Because that's why, I mean, last year, you kind of looked at me and laughed when we said the dump truck, because it was, by the way, it's $150,000.
Right, so.
Yeah, so you're at $150,000 at 1.9% is your interest rate. Which is lower than our bond.
What's that? When's the last time we bought?
2001, I think.
No, we definitely bought a truck.
But you bought a used.
Not a big dump.
Yeah, not a big dump. I'm talking about
I never bought a big dump.
I think our newest big dump is an 01, I think.
Oh, are we sure?
Well, you guys have it in your budget binders.
Yeah, I think in 07 and.
Well, you have it in your binder. I'm not.
No, yeah, I'm almost positive.
I have a replacement.
I remember this discussion.
And water sewer.
Check your capital for Public Works. You have. John actually prepared
a schedule.
So it'll tell us exactly what year they are.
Water, sewer, and general.
We would break it out overall for you.
I mean, at least 3 or 4 years, that dump truck has been high priority, and we just said no.
If we can lease and split over three funds, I think it's a very affordable option. But remember, that's for 3 years now. It's not just a one-year purchase. So we're going to have to plan that for 3 years.
I think another 10 or 3 years.
At 1.9%, you're not
doing anything like
that.
So the total outlay for the interest rate is 20 per month.
You have that too.
We have that.
28
now? No, I actually gave you a schedule. You actually have the schedule.
9,000, I think it would be. Wouldn't it from TD Bank? Would it be twice that 18,000?
I don't know that it's in your binder. I think I gave it to you as a loose.
I think you gave it to
Dale. I do remember seeing it.
And that's not taking down principal and figuring it out right.
Yeah, that's going on amortization.
If you don't amortize, yeah. I think you're right.
The amortization schedule is actually in.
Is it in your analysis?
No. I actually handed it to you.
But fire lease is our question.
And I you're asking.
I think there's a motion on the floor to lease. Are we correct? There's a motion that's properly seconded to lease.
I don't think that'll have a discussion.
Anyone want to make a motion?
I'll make the motion to lease a dump truck for 3 years.
Second by Mr. Schiff. Discussion? Mr. Brown?
What's our goal then for after the third year's up? Can we buy for a dollar? Are we going to buy then another truck? What's our future? I know we're doing one.
We have three that need to be replaced. My thought would be to replace all three, get one after the third year. I start on the next one.
Are we doing after third year or next year?
Well, I think you have to plan. I think you have to look at third year now, but maybe things will change in our favor, and there'll be the ability a year from now or 2 years from now to purchase another one. But we don't know that yet.
We don't want to
stretch ourselves thin by making into an agreement and then have major water main break. You know, if we have a year of water main breaks, we have major expenditures that aren't budgeted for. So I think I plan on one right now and hope that in 3 years we can get another one and see what the future holds.
Yeah, I'd like to see us just kind of progress in our replacing our.
We got to get on that.
We're getting better. Yeah, I mean, this is the dump truck we pushed off for 3 or 4 years.
You're right, Brian. It's
finally coming. So.
Yeah.
The question is, I think this year in particular, we know we need a dump truck, so we know we need to fix the culvert, we know we need it. Police cars. We know a lot of issues are Thursday you're going to get into the numbers of what those issues indicate.
Yes.
You know, at one point do we say, all right, we got to figure out a way to finance this without breaking the bank.
I do have one more question. I mean, so, and this may have come out in the last meeting, I apologize if I wasn't privy to that info, but and buying a used dump truck is not.
You're just buying somebody else.
Somebody else's issue. Somebody gets rid of a dump truck, it's because there's a problem, is what we were told.
Okay.
Once you buy your dump truck, you're keeping it for till it's shot.
It's like buying a new police car.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I just wanted to make sure that was properly, it's not like a car market where cars are turned over all the time. It's a separate industry.
Somebody's selling a dump truck, they're either bankrupt or they broke.
They broke. Yeah.
So motion's on the floor. All in favor of leasing the dump truck? You have six ayes. Next, you have library funding, which I believe you have budgeted at the
I haven't budgeted at their request.
At their request. Anyone feel differently about funding the library at their request?
So last year was.
Last year we cut. This year we're going back to the old number.
No, it actually increases.
Okay.
Yeah, it increases.
Mrs. Clark, go right ahead.
The amount for 2014 is the amount we requested for 2013.
Right.
Okay, so we're basically asking for the same thing we asked for last year.
Okay.
The 118 is what you requested last year.
Correct.
Anyone feel differently about funding to that level?
I'd like to see it stay at the same. As we progress, can we do that or no, Brian?
Stay at
100.
you can make that motion. I don't, I'm not comfortable doing it, but you can.
I would like to see it in, you know, I'm not sure about the 118, but I think 100 is too low for what they bring to the table. I mean,
but here's one of the things that you can do is, I mean, you can leave the number and see where numbers play out.
So far the numbers are all going up. That's your blind logic. I think we know where they're headed.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Mrs. Lawyer, are you looking, the one thing I'm familiar with is there's some counties that go regionalized, and you talked about that before. Do you think Lehigh County would do something like that?
Not in the foreseeable future. There's not a dialogue with a county. The county doesn't seem to be interested in that at this point. I don't know, maybe change in the, did they do an executive, didn't they? Or they cut into executive. I don't know, but there's not a dialogue going, and that would have to come, basically we work with Allentown, the Allentown Libraries, our district centers, we work with them, and that would be the people that would try to gather Lehigh County together, and gathering to be a county system. You've got to remember there are 10 libraries in the county, and each one is configured differently. So there's going to be a lot of, it's going to take a while, let's put it that way.
How's your electronic devices, your hardware, your computers, and things of that nature?
Thanks to the Mass General Authority, they've been very kind in providing us with approximately 4 or 5 new computers over the last several, maybe 4 or 5 years now. So we are pretty good. I only have a few tucked in corners that are still running Windows XP. I've got Windows 7 running on almost everything now.
XP. We still have 5 computers or 4 computers on XP here.
What? Once I have, or
no. I, well, it's not terrible. I mean, it's not terrible.
No, it's not terrible. It's just about saying.
Yeah. I'm sorry, 3. We still have 1 on Millennium.
We got rid of
all. That's terrible.
In other words, most of our computers are
junk.
Less than four or five years old.
Yeah.
So we're technology-wise, we're pretty good. We've been trying to keep up with everything else that's going on. We do have Wi-Fi in the building, and that's you know, just automatically comes with our internet service. So
yeah,
we don't have Wi-Fi. I've been pushing for Wi-Fi for a long time.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not important to you.
And we have an automated system to check out and everything like that. As you guys were mentioning earlier about point of sale and credit card stuff, gosh, we'd like to have that. I don't know how many people come in to pay their $6.30 fine and have no money on them.
So what's that extra $18,000 operating expenses for personnel?
I'm sorry?
Is that extra $18,000 for this year would be for personnel?
Well,
our
staff did not receive any increase last year, so that's what's going to take care of. That would help with that. Obviously, we are faced with the same expenses every year. We have cut everything that we possibly can already. This year, we're definitely be dipping into our reserve funds to balance out. Looking at the 118, that was going to possibly use a little bit of reserve funds, but not as much as we're using this year with only $100,000 from the borough. We are just at such a...
They're beyond bare bones.
Beyond bare bones.
Absolutely. And they're taking reserves. I mean, we cut hard last year. Mm-hmm. And if you are considering buying a dump truck, I think you also have to support the library. I mean, I don't think those two matter. But I mean, what we're thinking about spending the same amount, close to the same amount, I think you really got to think about it. I do. I think you've got to go see how many people use the library. And
well, that's why I asked about the hardware.
Let's leave it at the 118 for now and see where we end up.
I'm just going to put this comment out there. It doesn't necessarily give us the number, but I mean, libraries are changing so much. I mean, I think that we should start looking. We might have to change our number here. I'd rather see somewhere in between, really more or less as a compromise, if anything. But
114?
No, somewhere between 100 and 118, half of that is really.
Okay.
If we wanted to find a middle.
Well, I think, you know, because we something to talk about this one too, that is not on my major topics of discussion today, but
I guess all I want to say is that this whole thing needs some sort of resolve. I mean, we're going to have this problem will exist for eternity. I mean, it's going to change. And then to kind of go further on that is that I do have some concerns. I understand the concept of building the new building and all that, but are we definitely moving in the right direction? You know, I mean, I know I hear that all the time.
Community, the community center kind of thing is what we're working towards.
Right, and I agree with that. And I really like that side of it. I mean, I think
that
Emmaus residents have asked for that for a very long time. And I think that can be that, but is it the most efficient way to do it?
Have their, you know, coffee area and all that kind of stuff. The $100,000 figure that we worked with this year, that is actually a 2004 budget figure. So, I mean, that puts a little bit in perspective.
Yeah, obviously, I don't disagree. I mean,
we are not, there's nothing, you know, our people do not have any kind of benefits, no retirement plan, no health benefits, no dental, no vision.
I know you're not living large. Trust me, I get that. It's nothing direct. It's really just trying to see a little bit longer vision.
So you know that's what I'm saying. We're not asking for a lot of money. We're asking for something to help us maintain our services, and I think they're very important to your people.
I agree.
You've got to consider that it's one of the things that helps give the quality of life in this borough its value. And I think it's one of the things that, you know, get rated
in the
top
100 communities that you need to have a good time. $102,000 from 2001.
Well,
you're going to leave it here for now because Thursday is really when you guys are going to get through the numbers. But you're right, this has to be resolved. And every year we can't be.
Even my perception, this is not a negative perception, but my perception of where a library would go, I mean, I'm taking it from my age perspective, what I think my kids are going to look at it as, and then I also have to balance that with the senior citizens that are there and how they're using it. And I'm just trying to see a much, much bigger picture. I know we're not going to solve it in this year, but some sort of strategy towards that is really all I'm looking for. And that's why I don't want to say a number I'm just trying to at least get a conversation started.
Yeah, well, the idea is that we're talking about your full range of people, and your young people, such as yourself, they want us to have the electronic things, the e-books, the online resources.
Yep.
We still have to maintain the other things, and I think, as I pointed out before, the electronics books and things are not cheaper.
Yeah, oh yeah, no, I know. And that's why I've asked these questions. I mean, I only am so involved in the library.
We do not waste
the money.
We use it as wisely as we can, as carefully as we can. And I look at people working there, and they're not.
Oh, I know that.
It's worth it to your community, as valuable as your community, for more so because it's 12 months of the year.
More years.
There you go.
All right, so we've got to move on. I'd like to see it stay at that number for now, and we'll have to make that decision further into the future. Next are the grants, and I believe the grants, the Recreation Study and the Southwest Comprehensive Plan, are necessary. The other three are debatable, and I think those three will be debatable when it comes down to numbers. I mean, I think that's what it's going to come down to when we have to determine numbers. The Shade Tree, Revitalize the Streetscape, and LERTA are debatable once it comes down to numbers. I am not in favor of LERTA. The other two, I could go either way. I haven't done enough research to do. Am I correct that Recreation and Southwest Comprehensive Plan are necessary?
Well, the absolute most necessary is the Southwest Comprehensive Plan. Recreation Study, you guys voted to approve, apply for the grant.
Yeah.
Knowing that it's a 50-50 match, there's a very good chance we're going to get it.
So we've got,
but you're going to have to shell out the other half.
So those two must. Those two are must.
Your Shade Tree Revitalize grant is a 50-50 match. So again, you're going to be showing out 50% match. Your Streetscape grant
Same thing.
No, those are not, those are applied for or not?
They're not applied for.
Okay. So those are a decision to come once we know more numbers. Am I correct in that?
Yeah.
I'm off for now.
Okay. And then we're going to skip the department priorities for this evening, and we'll discuss department priorities once we have better numbers in the rest of it, because I don't think we can make capital decisions until we have operating expenses fully decided. Moving down to
water,
you
want to multi-user water fee. Absolutely.
The water multi-user fee.
I
believe that we're still charging a phantom fee. I believe that is not the most popular decision here. So it is now status quo. The way we've always had it is the way the water billing will continue unless we change, correct?
Yeah, but you, again, you said we will talk about this at budget time.
I agree.
I wrote that down.
I agree. So if anyone believes differently, I know I'm in the minority on that one of how the meter fees work. If someone believes differently, I believe something should be done. If no one feels that there is a reason to change that, we move on. I don't know if anyone feels there's a reason to change it.
What's your objection to it?
We charge someone for a meter that doesn't exist. I don't think it's fair to charge someone, like the apartment building, we charge them per meters. If you have an apartment, we charge you a certain meter fee for each unit, but they don't have meters. So we charge them a meter fee for a meter that doesn't exist.
So where would you make up that extra revenue? Well,
I have to increase water rates to make it up.
Which we did last year.
Right.
Don't forget.
That would go to our homeowners, right?
That would go to everyone.
Everybody.
I would just eliminate that fee, and I understand that it exists and that we need that revenue and we can't be without it.
You're saying it's expensive.
It's not. We put on someone's bill a fee for a meter, and that meter doesn't exist. Now, I do believe we've moved in the right direction of fixing it, but we haven't got there yet.
I don't think I'm in favor of taking it away.
You have in your the water revenue section, I believe, where
water revenue, you're correct.
The water pump is the description.
By Mr. Costa.
Yes, yeah, so last year I did a complete breakdown as to what you would need to do to raise rates based on decreasing multi-user charges. And that's where you guys have decided just to remove one charge per account. Mm-hmm. That gave us a $10,432 loss that we had to make up, in which case you did by raising rates. If you were to eliminate all of them across the board, it would be an additional $39,000.
So your residents, a regular person would see a significant increase.
Absolutely.
And why?
I think that's right.
What would it
to raise revenue by $39,000, you would have to raise your rates to, what are they right now?
$10?
$195,
I think. $195 for the first 40,000 gallons.
This was last year's analysis, so I think they're actually higher than $195. I think we raised them for this year.
I think you're right.
I think you're looking at somewhere between $2 and $2.25. So probably $2.15, $2.12, somewhere there, would raise that $39,000.
Connected users being.
I did this last year, and I know we raised the rate.
Well, there's 4,000. There's 4,000 hookups. Each one of those hookups would have to see $10 in the course of the year to make it up. And I understand the point that nobody wants to pay that extra money to solve something that is only affecting landlords.
Well, it's not just the landlords. Realistically, the tenants are paying.
Realistically, the landlord should be passing it on to the tenant, correct?
That's their right.
I agree. I mean,
so tenants are paying.
It's just the idea of, and maybe it needs to be reworded into some other way, the multi-user fee instead of a water meter charge. But
it is what it is right now. If no one has a feeling to change it, I'm perfectly fine with that.
To me, with the land, that's the cost of doing business. Just to pass along to anybody who owns a property. And I understand the other side of it, Brian, but...
And we've only ever had...
That's just what affects where it rented.
We've only ever had two people come to voice their complaints over it. It's not like every landlord in Emmaus has come to us and said, you need to fix this, this is killing me, I'm losing, I can't get tenants because of it. So I'm fine with moving forward.
All right, no change.
No change.
All right, I handed you, and Virginia, we're going to talk about this in detail tomorrow, but I handed you the
property sales.
The appraisals came in today. You open up page 2, those are the numbers you really care about.
Pack up page 2, so if everybody has time to read over this within the next few days, then it'll be discussed at GA how to move forward.
GA talks about tomorrow.
Very good. Tomorrow.
It's on their agenda with a dozen other things. So I told them before I go out. Pack breakfast and lunch. We're going to be there a while. All
right.
So that's there. They will speak about this in detail, and we'll talk to you Thursday. That's okay with you?
That's perfectly fine.
All right.
Next is your third-party services. Do you have some in mind?
Well, here's the thought is, and I want to get your feeling about this, because if I'm going to do this, I need to start preparing RFPs, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I need to know, we talked about this last year, we talked about it all the time. Are we okay with status quo and third-party services? And by that I mean solicitor, engineer, grass, because that could be renewed for one more year, I think. Garbage, right. Actuary. Maintenance for this, the custodial. I think the contract comes up. So the question for me to you is. Because at the beginning of the year, during your reorganization meeting, that's the best time for you to say, because then they don't take it personally.
Yeah.
It's the best time for you to say, we're going to put out a bid, or we're going to take bids. Now, if you're perfectly happy with your solicitor and his work, you can sit there and say, we're not dealing with going out for RFP on that service. I would definitely suggest that for your engineer, right? I think our engineer is very good. I think he's reasonable. I think he's done a great job for us. So, you know, if you're happy with one of the services, you think the price is, you know, reasonable, you don't have to put it out. You could say, you know what, we need to look at everything this year. We're going to do it all. That's 100% entirely up to you. You know what we're happy with. I think I made it clear when we're not happy. So it's your call as to how we approach that, but I would like to know well in advance before January 6th if we plan on going out for RFPs for services. So, because there's a lot of work in getting those bids and the packages together.
And that should come from this committee? Or is there another committee we should have that discussion?
No, I think this committee's as good as any.
Feelings.
I think there are certain things that we should start to bid. I'd actually want to see the entire list of bidable items. I don't think that would be a bad thing. I don't think that it can be a bad thing at all. You know what I mean? Even if we find our numbers just to confirm, yeah, we're on the right track. There are certain services that actually I don't want to consider. I mean, like you said, engineer, we're 100% happy with it. You know, maybe we save a few pennies, but in the long run, we...
Right.
So I don't want to do that kind of stuff, but...
Your refuse, services, you know, we went back and forth a dozen times, right? Your refuse last year. Mm-hmm. We're locked in for 2013, but we have to, by July 1st, make a determination as to whether or not we keep them. And if you remember, we started working on that as early as April of last year. So, that's why really the earlier the better, because like a cart or a one-month service, that's something that will have to go out right away.
Yes.
And wintertime is the best time to get anybody to bid on anything.
Of course.
Yeah.
Wait till the leaves fall.
Right.
So can you provide
can you
a list
you can
see?
Yep.
Although all of those.
I'll get that to you guys right after Thursday.
Okay.
Police pension COLA. And again, we mentioned we were bringing it to this committee or at budget time. So you have an actuarial that says the COLA would be, it's in $32,000, I think. And your feeling was we can't fund it in 2013.
But we'd like to fund it.
But we'd like to fund it in 2014. No, it's not in your budget.
Well, I don't think when we're talking about cuts that we're talking about, I don't know that police hole is going to make it.
So it's not in there. I guess I would ask that you would either give me a motion to put it in there or leave it out.
Make a motion to deny police COLA. First, you want it just to leave out right now?
I would
make a motion to deny their COLA request. I'll make that motion. Is there a second? Talk about abstention. Discussion. Wes.
When was the last time that it was appropriate?
2009.
How much are we talking?
$32,000 in one shot.
You have to pay it all in one time. It's over 12 years, but you have to pay it up front. It's $2,000 for all of them for the year. The increase. The recommendation from the pension board wants to authorize it back in February. When
yeah.
We talked about February.
Yeah.
And then it was denied by council. So.
Does that catch us up then? Or?
It would give them a COLA based on the cost of living from 2012 to 2013 is what it you could go all the way back to, you could retro-rate it, is that even, you know what I mean?
Retro-fit?
All the way back to last time, the
option.
Retroactively fun.
There we go. That
word. So you have to fund all 32, you can't fund 10,000.
Right.
Fund
that 32,000 was just based on cost of living from 12 to 13.
But you have to pay it for 12 years.
Yes. That it's a one-time $32,000 payout.
It's a lump sum that you pay.
But that covers a 12-year span of...
Well, it covers 12 years.
Right.
So it's $32,000.
No,
divided
it covers
by
the 30 years. Yeah, it is.
Basically, but
we're paying that.
But you have to pay it
up front.
That's how the actuarial, that's lawfully how the actuarial
so
works.
Council wouldn't have to deal with it again.
No, they'll come back in a year.
It's
just that 1 year. It's just to increase that 1 year into the future. So they're going to ask for it every year.
Which we get every year.
Every year we get the request.
And because I don't remember, it sounds like you looked at the numbers. So 2009, we did it. Prior to that, were we doing it consistently?
No.
We were skipping. It's historically that we do skip them.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I didn't think that it was abnormal going into a bid year. How this seems.
No, I mean...
I think
that's an important number for you to understand. That's the number that you pay out in their retirement, just for health care. So I'm going to tell you, I would not feel bad when we're deciding whether or not we fund a library or a dump truck, when we're still paying that number out at 100%, and you say no to a COLA,
paying all their insurance costs.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is a number that you don't get in many towns. And next year's number is $424,000. And not to mention life insurance for someone, which isn't much, but it's still a number. And not to mention health insurance reimbursements for retirees. and other items that the retirees benefit from. Now, that number's for all retirees. That's not just for police.
Yeah.
But, again, I think it's something that when you're looking at the entire big picture here, you need to keep in mind that if they whine and cry, you can still tell them you're one of the few people in America that still have free health care. It's your decision, but I want to throw that out at you. But
I just hung up.
Your name's not on that list, buddy. You're not getting done. Good try, though. So there's a motion on the floor to deny the COLA increase. You can properly second. All those in favor of the denial? We have five. Mr. Schultz to the left, and Dr. Waddell's on his way out. Thank you for being here, Dr. Waddell. I appreciate your time.
I did tomorrow morning if you want to come to another.
I think maybe 10 more minutes of stuff.
That's fine. Yeah, that's fine. Your financial monitoring work results.
Yeah, we're not talking about that today.
Your remodeling project.
Let's talk about the town hall remodeling project. I think we can get that done in
2 hours.
Yeah, maybe.
I just have to have a kid voice the other by 7 o'clock on Tuesday night.
There's good news on the project so far, and that is the architect budgeted $17,000 to do electrical emergency lighting in the building, ADA improvements to the ramp and the entranceway. We're replacing both the doors and the entranceway. And what a ridiculous number, a $5,000 rail to meet ADA requirements. And that's the cheapest we could get. You want aluminum at $7,000. His cost estimate was $17,000. We're at like $11,000 with everything. So we have $6,000 that we can move into the next phase, which is the fire, knocking out all this glass up here and putting in fire resistant walls, which we have to do by code. The rest of this project is $37,000, which is, again, it's in your numbers. Are we budgeting that entire amount for next year and moving forward with this, or?
As of now, yes. You already budgeted it.
Number 34,000.
So you've got to keep it in right now.
If I remember correctly, it's just really refreshing on the things that happened, because I don't think it's one that we can split up. I think it's a do it all right.
That is the actual, we can finally do the downstairs.
Right, yeah, I didn't think we could split
it
up. Yeah. So. An all or nothing.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yes. That finishes the project, though.
Does that include any HVAC
window air conditioners?
That's part of your five year. That's part of your 5 year.
So we don't.
No, that's.
Can't afford it yet.
Yeah.
We're talking, one in front of that 34. Maybe two.
Until you start opening things.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Soon you'll be like, I need a new building.
So, do we really need to do an HVAC and not just a ductless type unit?
No, I think there's several options. Look, we've only looked at one or two.
Right. Yeah. There's options, but the windows are. From when? I mean, 50 years ago?
Right.
So there's a major expense to do everything. This would at least reconfigure.
Well, this does reconfigure.
I've been on the board the whole time, so
yeah,
I understand.
That's what the staff in the building is after first. The windows are an issue.
In that reconfigure, did they get done?
They're not part of the reconfigure. We're looking at $64,000, I think, for windows. I think is what the cost estimate that was given to us was. I spent $14,000 in my house, and those are half the size of most things like this. You know, I mean, it's doing windows This is not cheap.
Especially in
stone. And we're probably looking at custom sized windows.
Yeah. And they're putting them back in stone. Yeah,
it's an expensive endeavor.
All right, let's leave it in for now.
Leave it in.
It's all
surveillance, locks, buy, lease, or nothing.
Yeah, so part of the reconfiguring is, and not all, that's not tacked into here, but we received three or four different quotes on surveillance, meaning video cameras, and the locks, which we need the locks. We need the locking system more than anything. One of the companies offered a leasing program to do the entire package, which you have in there. I put in a budgeted number. I think it was under office. Yep. So it would be $78.41 a year for 3 years. Would pay for the entire thing. Now, these guys swear by their product. This guy over here has
so
different
much.
Opinions.
you can lease it? You can lease the surveillance
system? From the company, that would be a little better.
Is that the best way to go?
Unless you want to spend $24,000 up front. Now, the two companies he had come in were more like $54,000.
Nick, can you, I mean, you're obviously the one that's most involved in this. Can you give your explanation or reason?
For leasing?
Leasing
versus buying?
Just in general.
I mean, the product, you don't have to leave. The product doesn't go out of date. I mean, the only time, you have a small number of employees, they'll get key fobs or anything of that nature. And, you know, if somebody would turn around.
The leasing thing is changed.
Yeah, but the thing is the hardware doesn't, it's very rare that it breaks down or does anything of that nature. It's very rare unless it's destroyed by fire or rain or water, anything like that. But, usually the hardware is good for about 20 years.
Yeah, so this is a lease to buy, by the way. This is a financing option of, do you want to spend the money up front or spread it out over 3 years, okay? I think the bigger question, Nate, is the product.
Yeah, the product, I think, is just an inferior product compared to the others that are being out.
What are we talking about? The keypad at the door so you can swipe in.
You get a keypad.
Office door, so this.
And it has a software program that we would know
that tracks it out
and whatever.
And it would be building or it would be office door?
So,
except for
building would be
programmable
during open hours, the door.
Somebody unlocks it and then no one has to do that. But they would still be fobbed into, like Christine's keypad. But
when we put that.
But same kind of idea of security.
Yeah.
What do you think, Christine?
About
security systems downstairs. I think it's necessary.
I think
you need it at the front entrance.
It came from that.
Okay.
The entire idea of secure doors came from staff.
Actually, just looking at the news. Very good point. And I agree. So now it's just getting the best
places you can walk in and walk anywhere you want in the building.
I mean, you have no idea how many times I'm on the computer working on something and I woke up and
somebody's right there
standing on me.
Every time, isn't it?
Luckily,
yes. Now, is it the camera systems required also to know when to allow somebody in and not allow somebody
in? No. The camera system is again, you have a public building. Things happen in public buildings. The camera system is set to do surveillance around the outside of the building and in public spaces inside the building. It would not be in offices. It would be in the hallway. It'd be at the entranceways. Basically, you're trying to secure your entire building. To me, that's the part of it. And this guy, again, sells it for a living, so we can talk about it more.
$8,000 a year for 3 years, and then we own it. And Nate, you think it's an
inferior product? From this company.
And you think it's an inferior product that won't work well.
What page is that? Do you have the specs?
General government section in the middle of it.
So
that is something that should go through public safety, I would assume. Have you discussed, has that been discussed there yet?
No, Dan has handled all the renovations.
Okay.
Okay. We're at a point now where
it's do or die.
We're a budget time.
Okay.
funding is what was totally generated.
Okay.
I mean, if you're going to go with Chief, you're going to get Chief. And if, you know, Chief Faust has to look at the video and detectives look at the video and go, well, that's too pixelated. I can't see. I can't make out the person. Then that's what you're going
to
get.
But I think before you say that, I think we need to compare the specs.
I agree. Like, do we have quotes from
expenses?
So we have all the quotes that are in here. I haven't put the time into looking through that, so I will have to do that. We'll have to look at that more. And has Chief House reviewed it, or anyone from the police department reviewed it? Do they know it? I mean, would somebody there be no one else to tell us something?
No, the guy that installs it for a living is probably right. your best bet. I don't know, Pete.
I mean,
Nate's actually been very instrumental in helping with this.
Okay.
There is such a price difference between them, though. I can tell you, I put in a 16 camera system that was as good as any, and I did that for $12,000. So, you know, is the quote that I'm telling you is the least expensive from this FBI.
CIA. I don't think all CIA.
Yeah. Is that outrageous for their camera system? No, I don't think it is. This is out of my league. You know, this is not. I agree. If I get something that can capture something every 30 seconds, it's not going to cut it.
It's out of my league, too, so I don't know.
You know, this.
You go to Home Depot and buy one right now.
I can do that for $1,100.
Yeah, online you can get cheap.
Right. I can do that for $1,100.
Black Friday prices
here. Looks like you know what you're doing.
Yeah. Black Friday shopping for the
first.
So I guess leave it in. Right? I guess you have to leave it in right now because we need something. Now, if someone's going to make a motion to do something different, that's understandable, but I don't know enough about it yet.
I think that the priority level should be card access and security first, then cameras second.
I absolutely agree.
I think that if you prioritize it, that's where I would go.
You're stopping the problem. The other is a reactive to it.
Yeah, the other is, yeah, exactly.
Is after the problem happens, you look back, right?
That's it. That's
because you're not going to use the cameras to look at to decide whether to let a person in the door or not.
Well, they have a separate system of that if somebody rings a bell.
Oh, right. I mean, we have that. We used to have that at my school, but now that we went to FODS, they can see the door, but it's not anymore. Buzz you in.
I want a 50-inch television mountain. Over my head.
You want the Lehigh Center.
It's not going to be any good down at the pool.
You want the Lehigh County Cop Center.
We'll do.
You
want to
bring in
D.A.
Martin.
But you're not going to be able to react from that.
Yeah, I think the security level is very important.
So you think the FOB system of...
You can hold off on the cameras. If I would request or suggest anything, hold off on the cameras and go forward with the key FOB.
So keep that amount in and... Can you then present us with something of that nature?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So I think we'd be making a mistake to say, no, let's not worry about security. Figure that out later.
It's come up since Bruce Boswell was here every year. It must be an issue.
All right, what else you got? You need to yell at
it. It is.
I know, that's what I mean. It's not excellent.
So we're going to talk about compost fees. First of all, I have a gentleman who is upset about the way that we handle the compost fees. I think he came
to Dale Washburn because his tenants have to pay the fees, correct?
Yes.
I don't necessarily agree with him on that because if his tenants produce anything vegetative, they're going to take it there. His tenants have all kinds of houseplants there. Do they cut them and take them? Do they at some point take something? So
you have bipolar water compost.
Yeah.
Awesome, Jerry.
That's
what
happens when he goes on vacation.
Doesn't
somebody have to take the grass down?
Well, I don't know. He's not there, and somebody's using the water, though. I mean,
he hasn't complained about that yet, though, right?
Probably hasn't picked up on that yet. I informed him that, again, we would talk about this at budget time.
And that was multi-unit. We charge them.
That was every resident has to.
Every resident. It's added on their bill.
Well, not people who live in a place that they use a dumpster.
Correct.
So if he would get a dumpster on his property, if he would get a dumpster, I believe it would be cheaper than the trash fees for 4 units.
Are they allowed to put that waste in?
No, but they wouldn't be paying a fee to use compost because they have a dumpster.
So can a resident that lives
in... Oh, you have to pay the $6 to use it, you have to come in and get a card.
Yeah. Because like a resident that lives in...
And he's asking if you could put that type of
trash... He couldn't, but then those people wouldn't have to pay the fee to use compost that they don't use.
It also depends on who the provider would be, if they would allow that kind of trash.
But his argument is those people don't produce vegetative waste, so why should they be paying $6 to use compost when he's the only one who does? So if he would put a dumpster on his property, those people wouldn't have to pay the $6 fee unless they chose to.
And is he permitted to?
I don't think so.
What was the requirement?
I think this is a guy who owns a house and has an apartment.
No. Yeah, he's got a building with at least 3 or 4 units.
Yeah, but I thought there was a number that if you were over a certain number, then you could do that. Maybe
I don't know. I thought anybody could get a dumpster. Like if you have a construction business, you can.
We have
rules. I couldn't do it at my office. I don't think so.
You can't.
If there's something.
No, I'm shaking my head because I can't answer that.
Okay. I thought anyone could get a dumpster.
I thought we set a number for.
Because I thought like if you
size of the union.
I think we do.
I think it's based on employees at businesses, but I don't know about rental.
We have a lot of theories.
But I don't have an interest in changing the way we... Anyone have an interest in changing the way we assess the compost fee with the refuse bill?
No.
And if you can stop there, I appreciate it.
Just one more thing.
Yeah.
Online bill pay.
Let's do it. Let's bother.
Let's get it done.
I just have one question.
Oh, boy.
My answer is yes.
What do you want, hardware from ME, Millennium?
No. The question is, who eats the fee, us or them?
Are we going to do credit card or just checking?
You have the fee no matter what.
Right, I know, but it's a significantly different fee.
You got to do it. I would allow both.
I agree.
Okay. If we're going to do both, the checking is significantly lower. The convenience of it, that amount we save in total effort from the employees. I think a credit card starts to get fairly high. I mean, probably it's going to be somewhere around 2.5 to 3%, maybe even higher. And that fee probably couldn't be made up. But I think the check, when it's directly connected to a checking account,
a direct deposit
is like
directly wrong.
0.5. I mean, you gave us numbers.
I gave you numbers from the very first company, which was Express Bill Pay. Since then, I have probably 6 or 7 different, including again TD Bank offers, which is a local bank that offers that service. Which I mean, they do everything from the online bill pay to the credit card machine to pay the credit card on the computer. Which to me, I would prefer that rather than having any kind of machine in any of our facilities.
Yeah, I agree.
Including ambulance. I would rather the ambulance take a credit card and enter it on the computer rather than us swiping it and having data.
Well, yeah, the fee is, the most expensive fee is anyone that has an actual swipe card. The cheapest is if it's done online.
Yeah.
Because of the security risk.
Right.
So,
Enid,
if service fees are based on the amount $1 through $100, $3.50 fee.
We don't need that.
So
if
I
have
$100
water bill?
$100 through $200 is $6.75.
So we're paying extra $6 for
the PayPal's cheaper than that.
This is through eNetPay, which accepts credit cards, electronic checks.
Yeah, what's the rest of the world do? I don't know.
Well, no, everybody has a different company. I mean, that's the thing, is there are so many out there, and that's why all I'm asking you right now is, do you want me to find a company where we eat the cost, or the end user eats the cost? Because there's...
Checks, us, it's a lower fee, it streamlines everything. Also, it's moving into the center.
If somebody puts their routing number in and does it that way, you're saying that's a check? Like, electronic pay is the check, and then we can eat the fee on that.
Yeah,
and credit card
we could go to the, I mean, realistically, just like everything that you probably pay anyhow now. I mean, there are many things that...
The problem is the system, though. These systems, okay, so we eat the fee on the checks, but we can't go by a system where it's we the check costs and the credit card costs.
You can't do that.
None of these systems that I found. Basically, it's like, here's the service we offer. Here are the fees, and they've all been polarized in terms of they do it this way, they do it this way. None of them that I've seen so far.
Then if no one's willing to do that, then I would say, I think that maybe separate kind of how these things are being used then, and say for annual things like water, refuse, all those things, those are things that a check card could be put in. If there are other fees, a fee at the ambulance or a fee at the library, and have a separate service that does just our credit card.
Here's a number that I find alarming with us eating the cost.
No,
so the rep from TD Bank had said 70% of the users will end up using the online stuff. That's their record. Is that 70% will end up using the online version of payment, or if we go even farther and say that percentage has to be bigger if somebody comes in here. Like, I don't write checks.
I've never written a check in 10
years. I'll bring in my debit card and swipe the thing, but if I have to write a check, it's usually not on time. I forget.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is the only bill I still pay.
Yep. Right.
Not by check.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
I think that 70% is probably a legitimate number.
Well, the number of people who are going to use the service that are going to cost us dollars each.
What's the average water bill? Just out of curiosity,
what's the average water bill?
Lone
trees
would be a better person.
Quarter,
the ones that I see, there's a bunch in
mid-six. I was going to
say,
between
40 and 60.
Yeah. Something like that?
Every quarter.
And what is that fee? Leanne, you say?
$350.
$350.
Times 4 times
$100. Now, if a person goes on automatic bill, one of them is, if they go on automatic bill pay, we need the cost for it instead of lower.
Right, yeah, it's the ACH.
So really all I'm saying is, do we want, because we'll find the right company at the lowest cost.
Right.
But at the end of the day, is it, do we want to eat it or do they want to eat it? For example, we have in the ambulance budget, we pay out a certain amount of money every year for processing fees. You know, and that number in the ambulance is...
Are we close there?
What?
$100 a month.
How much?
It would be like $100 a month.
You guys
use
that much?
That we pay.
We collect a lot more since we're using it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I think
people will pay their bills if those
are credit portion for our standard stuff, we should do. If we eat the fee, 70%, that means that there's 70% less pieces of paper that come in that someone has to type in this number, type in that number, file it. You know, it's already done. It's just someone at the end of the day closing that. Account.
Somewhere around 800 bucks. You use your credit card places, though. You know what I mean? You don't go to the store, but they must build it into their price.
Well, you do. I can name some businesses. Like, for example, if I got something notarized, what's the notary?
EG
notary. So I went there and I swiped a card. They would say, it's 3% to do this, or cash is at this price, or check is at this price. I mean, that was one. I just was there recently, but.
But most places you just go and they've already built that price into.
Well, that's what a lot of the markets do, is they'll build it into your pricing.
But there are, I'm trying to think of some of the utilities. I think UGI for a while would actually charge you if you did that in their utility.
And we almost would have to for next year, because we're not going to change all our prices to do it, so we don't have to eat it next year for the convenience and see how it plays out. But what's eaten is going to be. Is that going to be $40,000?
Well, we're only at $762 for the ambulance one.
Yeah, that's
That's 9 months.
But if it's $350 a person on each water bill, and they do that four times a year, you're at $14 for each water user.
What if you?
And you might be at 3,000 water users doing that, which is
$40,000. But again, that's credit card, not check.
So what if you just do that for now, for the year coming up, and then reassess after?
We could probably contract a company for 1 year and have the end user
pay the fee.
And really, you should probably do it for 2 years, because in year one,
yeah, that's true.
You know, you're just getting it started. Year two is where I think you're, you know, people are going to be signed up and yeah, people know.
Is that even feasible, though, Shane? Or just
I think so. I think so. I what I wouldn't do is in year one or year two, eat the cost. I'm very leery about.
If you eat the cost, you have to know if we have to have an idea of what we're eating.
That's,
are we eating
$20,000
or $40,000?
And that's what I'm saying.
The unknown for me, I think, is
I mean, even, actually, I was thinking about it, even in the 5K race, everyone ate the cost for it. Everyone paid the cost for it, to use the credit card.
It's a convenience fee. You're right. It was on there that you had to pay a convenience fee.
Because at the end of the day, you can still write a check.
Yeah.
You don't want to pay.
Yeah, you can still show up and write your check. You're right.
Or bring cash.
Yeah. But, again, I'm trying to say, for credit card convenience, without. And if they have to be two separate things that we're doing, if we start with just one, figure it out. We just need a number. We're doing a high number. I think the number is much lower than what is out there.
I agree. I think there's a company out there that we can do this. But that's why I'm just asking you today.
Yes, let's move forward.
Yes, which philosophy do we want?
Put the fee on them.
No questions.
Plan on putting the fee on the users now. Right? Plan on putting the fee on the user for now, and we'll adapt as we find
out. I agree.
I have a good friend in the business. I will call him tonight and have him come see you. That's what he does for
me.
Now, he may be the hardware guy that makes money. I'm not sure what he fully, but he'll know the industry well.
I think there's enough companies out there that we can find a good one.
I get 10 merchant service calls a week from businesses trying to get us to do
it. That's enough for you for tonight. Motion to adjourn.
I'll move.
For a second. I'll make that second. All in favor? Good, 5 eyes, we're out.
See you Thursday.